the ride quality's not there, but I would say probably right now, no one is doing screenless in Pennsylvania. Right now, I'd say probably about 40% of our jobs are being built screenless. And I kind of assumed the same thing was true here, and I thought about making a screenless presentation to you guys, but I figured you're already on top of it, so. We're not gonna talk about screenless today, but. What's happening here, Larry? You want me to make the presentation here? Alright, thank you. So the object of the game of this whole program is to, you know, increase use of these kinds of technologies, like the real-time screenless. And they have several tasks that are involved. FHWA and Sharp Program has an equipment loan program, and you can apply to that program for a particular job with a particular contractor. It was kind of interesting, PennDOT has been interested in doing more of this, and so they applied to the program for a particular project, and it turned out that the contractor that got it was one I was telling about, they've already got the equipment. They ended up not participating, but it does allow, as it says here, full use of a real-time screenless system for 2 weeks, onsite technical support and training. Gary Fick comes out and helps with implementation with both contract and DOT side. Gives a little bit of, again, a free loan of this equipment out there. They're looking for projects that have at least 10 consecutive mainline paving days or more. And if you're interested in doing this, here's Gary's contact information, gfick@trinity-cms.com. So if you got a project coming up, you think it might be something fun to try and you get your feet wet with, give Gary a shout on email. They're also doing some regional showcases, open houses. And they've got a number of workshops that they're doing around the country. So again, if IDOT's interested in having a workshop done, 4 or 5 hours, and really learn about the nuts and bolts of how these systems work, instead of the 15-minute Reader's Digest abridged version that I'm giving you here today. Again, contact Gary, and he can put you in touch with the folks with the Sharp program to do that. And they are in the process then of documenting the experience from all these implementation activities. There's nothing out there at this point, but that will be out in the future. Another task would be developing specifications, guide specifications for states that want to implement this, kind of a plug-and-play type of a spec for using these things. You can make modest modifications to those. Then the last is to prepare these outreach materials, brochures and field reference guides and things of that nature. So it's a pretty good program. It's just kind of getting started here on the implementation side, but I think the technology is a good technology. Again, it's another tool in the toolbox for helping us to build better, longer-lasting, smoother concrete pavements. So, what we're all about. I can't answer a lot of questions about it. I pretty much shot my wad here in terms of giving you the information I know about it, but I'll take a stab at it if you got any questions. It's an easy one, I might be able to do it. What do you got?
So, the equipment loan program, I take it you're not loaning us this whole paper, this is equipment that we monitor for rent.
I'm not sure I understand the question, but the equipment is, you're going to get either a Gameco or a Ames system that'll bolt onto the back, and they'll provide that and the training and bolt that on and bridge on the back of the paver, or however it goes on. They're not providing a paver, if that's what you're asking.
You're not
getting a retrofit. Yeah, the retrofit to the contract is existing equipment.
Right.
Right. So you have to have a contractor that's willing to cooperate and participate in the program.
How would this be implemented? The supplier's
okay, the question is, where is the incentive for the contractor to do this kind of stuff, and is it specification driven?
Risk mitigation.
Yeah, it
was driving in
Pennsylvania. Here's what Robert said here.
I think from a national perspective, it's really just risk mitigation on the contractor's side. The equipment does not cost that much, and the contractors that are out front and adopting this equipment quickly their employees, as soon as it's on the paper, they're watching that, because that's what they can really control. Something as simple as when they're in dumping trucks and not using a placer spreader before the slip form equipment. Every time that the slip form paper gets up to a head of concrete, it has to lift a little bit to push that forward, and they can see that immediately in the screen. So they figure out, what do we need to do to change our process to make it smoother now? And it's, in the end, from a DOT perspective, I guess it's your smoothness specification that will drive them. If they're having any sort of challenges meeting the smoothness spec, this is one way that the contractor can get to that point and control their risk as well.
And control the risk means controlling the risk of having to make modifications after it's in play, going back and doing the bump grinding, minimizing, reducing the bump grinding, eliminating a lot of problems. So, the good contractors, I think, are interested. You know, you have a specification in place, kind of drives the ones that aren't proactive. Okay, next.
I was just questioning whether you, why you actually need a specification to use it.
Oh, you don't have that one either.
Of course, but you use it right now.
Yes.
And I not
just for real time feedback, right?
They still have a smoothness spec, so if they were having problems or you wanted to get a bonus, you have that option.
Right. Ever hear what Jeff had to say there?
Can they throw in on the back of the germ compound sprayer or the timer and get the like the final finish as well and use that for the incentive as well?
I don't know if you have enough of a stable platform with the curing cart to, because you have to have a pretty solid reference frame that the mold these things do. I don't know. It's a good question. I've never seen one done that way. Randy, what do you know?
They have put them on the tining machine, tining cure machines. And they work pretty good back there. But one of the advantages you have, if you mount it right to the paver, is that's where a lot of the action happens.
Right. The cost was not that high. Maybe the boat did.
Well, you could do both.
Yeah, go with your incentive right away.
Well, if you guys put enough incentive on it, they're happy to put those things on here.
I think, as Randy said, you're trying to put it where the things that you're going to impact are happening right behind the paper. Put it behind the curing cart. Now it's almost looking like you can use it as a replacement for your profiling the next day for your regular profiling operations.
Right.
And is that a single
point laser or footprint?
No, they've got three lasers off each one of those.
What's the points?
I'm not sure.
I'll add one other thing. Yeah. The advantage, as you're pointing out, one of the advantages you would have is if you had one on the paver and on the curing, or on the tiny cure machine.
You can see what those finishers are doing.
You can see what those finishers are doing. Yeah. And what we've learned in doing an awful lot of this, that paver does a pretty good job, and it just goes downhill from there most of the time.
Yeah.
It's not always. I mean, you get some that doesn't close up, you still need those guys back there. We don't need them as much as we thought we
could. No. And a lot of that, I don't know how it is around Chicago, but I got a guess. In Pennsylvania, they got a union requirement. They got X number of finishers behind the paving machine, no matter how many they actually need. And a lot of times, the job is best served if both those guys are just leaning on the equipment and not touching it. I lived up in Minnesota for a while, and we had some really good concrete pavers up there. Minnesota's done a lot of tweaking their mix designs. They're one of the first adopters of optimized mix cures with very dense aggregate gradations and mixes that stand up well, low water cement ratios, and low cementitious contents. And they rarely had more than two finishers behind a paver. And most of the time, those guys are just kind of leaning on stuff too. Because when they touch it, they might be able to dress up, make them look better, but they would be inducing little variations in pavement profile that you couldn't see, but they were driving their IRL. Okay, let's move on to the next topic here. We're going to be struggling to get through stuff at this point. Super air meter. The main guy in this is Tyler Lay. He's a professor at Oklahoma State University. These are probably all the grad students that have worked on it over the last few years. Tyler wanted to be sure to acknowledge these folks, Oklahoma Transportation Center, CP Tech Center, the Portland Cement Association, as well as all the states that have contributed money to that pooled fund. And you'll notice only DOT here in bold has contributed $20,000 to $30,000, I think, over a couple of years to the development of this technology. So if we're going to talk about this, do we have to have that thing up there on top to kind of block out our titles?
Move to the side.
They can work around it, they can title it and tell people what it's about, they can't read. We need to step back first and talk about why we need to have air and concrete. What the super air meter is a way of taking kind of a basic piece of equipment we've all been familiar with for years and years, pressure-based volumetric pressure meter for determining the air content of concrete, and it takes it to the next level. Instead of getting just total air content, it's going to give us an indication of the quality of that air void system, something that we traditionally have only been able to get at by measuring the hardened air content of the specimens, cutting it, polishing it, looking at it under a microscope, measuring the air voids. This is a way of getting at an indication of those numbers, which really indicate the quality of the system in real time, again. And we need air entering bubbles, why? The freeze-thaw durability, right, of the paper. We're given the water, kind of a pressure leak, place to go to, water likes to expand when it freezes. We've got water in the capillary system of the concrete, gets down below freezing, wants to expand, gives it some place to go. If it's got no place to go, stresses build up. That's a fracture of the concrete. Stresses get you too high. But, so we need to have that stuff in there, but again, just purely air volume does not necessarily mean you're going to have freeze-thaw performance. We need to have some attention to the sizes of the bubbles. And typically it's bubbles that are smaller than about a tenth of a millimeter in diameter that are the ones that are effective in giving us freeze-thaw durability. And to a point, you know, a tenth of a millimeter in diameter, that's kind of the top end. We want even smaller stuff than that. Microscopic sized bubbles. This is, if we're doing hardened air measurement, this is what it would look like. This might be a slice of a concrete specimen. And these lines would represent what we'd see if we were doing this microscopic measurement. What they do is they put this specimen on a stage, it moves under a microscope, and someone's pushing a button every time you see an air void, holding it down so that it measures the length of every air void along the length of this line. So you're getting kind of a sampling along each one of these lines. But you can see as you look at this, you can see some pretty decent sized bubbles. You see one here that's really big, that's an entrapped air void. We're looking for the nice small ones, they tend to be fairly spherical in shape. We've got some bigger ones, we've got some little tiny ones. They all count. But as it turns out, again, you know, it's the small ones that really give us the most benefit. This circle and these 25 smaller circles have the same volume. This indicates why it's not just volume. If you're looking at concrete, you don't want to see this one big bubble and you got all this paste out here that's unprotected. It's a long way from here to the edge of that bubble for a water molecule to travel to get to a place where it can get away from the pressure of the expanding water behind it. Whereas if you got this system where the bubbles are pretty close together, the water never has to travel any more than half the maximum distance between the bubbles. So smaller is better. When you measure with our typical air meters, we're just measuring total volume. We don't know if we have this or if we have this. Historically, the only way to get to this in real time, there's not been a way to do it in real time. We could cast the specimens and then chop them up, cut them, polish them, have someone with a microscope to look at them. That takes a long time. There have been some other devices that have been developed, but they've had limited acceptance, let's say. You might have heard of the air void analyzer system that was developed in Kansas. Kind of a mixed bag of results on that, but so far people seem to be accepting this test that we're talking about here. Here's our real concrete system. Here's kind of an idealized thing where you've got the bubbles are all spaced uniformly in the corners. We make these assumptions. But again, you'll hear a term called spacing factor. That's the maximum distance, in theory, that a water molecule would have to travel to find the boundary of an air bubble where it can experience relief. And that is half the average distance of an average-sized void, assuming that they're all uniformly distributed in the face. So we're assuming these bubbles are all in this lattice here, and the maximum distance is from the center of the cube out to any one of the corners. A number of studies over the years going back into the 1940s, pretty consistent in suggesting that the desired value for that, you want to have that spacing factor, needs to be less than 0.008 inches. That's really close. That's a lot of bubbles really close together. Or 0.2 millimeters if you're a metric. Okay? And of course, we can't use air volume for the reasons we've talked about. But this also illustrates another reason why we can't just use pure air volume. Sometimes air volume by itself doesn't even correlate real well with that spacing factor because of the fact that, and these are some lab tests that were done, These are mixtures that have just air and training admixture in them. These are the blue diamonds that you see here. And we might say, all right, here's the, we've measured actually the spacing factor on these mixtures. And if we look at anything less than about, in this case, maybe less than 4.5% air in that case, gives us spacing factors that are above that 0.008. So if we always use this mix and always use that air entraining admixture, we might know pretty confidently that when we have more than 4.5% air, the trend follows this line, then we're always going to have spacing factors that are below 0.008. So we wouldn't need to know any more than that. We always use that mix and that air entraining admixture. But what if we got in a job and the mix is a little stiff, so the contractor starts to use that air entraining admixture and a particular high-range water reducer also to pick up his workability? Same mix, same air entraining admixture, and now we start looking at what happened to the air void system. The use of the high-range water reducer made the mix a little more fluid, so now you got these little microscopic bubbles, and they're in the mixture, and they're banging into each other, and they bang into each other, and they form bigger bubbles. Your bubble size just went up. Same air content, but the bubble size just went up. So now your spacing factor, your bubble size goes up, your spacing factor goes up, because it's further between bubbles now. You got fewer bubbles further apart. So if we were to look at this, that same threshold of maybe 4.5% or 5% air as being acceptable, and anything more than that was good, we've got numbers that are more than that now that are up here with big spacing factors, and it's not going to be durable. Here's another look at the same kind of a thing, looking at the spacing factor and how it actually related to the freeze thaw testing, because the proof's in the pudding, right? Here's the freeze thaw testing results. And anything that's a solid symbol was one that actually did survive the standard freeze thaw tests, but the hollow symbols are those that fail freeze thaw durability. So clearly we need to have a better handle on it. This is looking at cord lengths, cord distances, another measure of the same sort of thing, showing that the bubbles are getting further apart. So, commonly we look at, and our specs are set up for what? What's IDOT look for? 6% plus or minus 1.5? 6.5? What's your spec for air?
5 to 8.
So you're 6.5 plus or minus 1.5. Okay. And that's pretty typical, pretty common. But again, volume of air alone, as we've just shown, does not equal the quality of the air void system. We can look at hard air void analysis. That takes a long time, very expensive. $400-$600 per specimen that you do. That's one tiny little sample. So what we've needed, what Tyler recognized, was the need to have a test that would give us a quick quantification of the air void system and an indication of what the hardened air system is going to look like. And so what they did was they modified the standard pressure meter so it would hold larger pressures without blowing up and hurting somebody. Need a few other minor modifications. And now it takes a little longer to do, but it's still only 8 to 10 minutes. And they've got equipment that will take it down to 5 to 6 minutes. There's your AirBot. Looks an awful lot like the old standard AirBot, doesn't it? Except yeah, you got more clamps on it. We got 6 clamps on it now. We got a little different bleeder valve. We got a higher capacity pressure chamber here. But for those of you that haven't been out in the field and know how these things work, we're going to fill this pot up with concrete, consolidate it according to 3 layers, 25 blows per layer, strike it off, clean off the seal there, you put the lid back on it, clamp the lid down, and you fill it up with water, and then you're going to pressurize this chamber here to a particular pressure, then you release that into the lower chamber. There's a little valve. You're pressurizing this, and then you push down on a valve, which then releases that air into the lower chamber, and you got concrete, you got sand, you got sand, you got cement, you got water, you got air. If I change the pressure on that, which of those things are going to change in volume? Only the air, right? The rest of the stuff's pretty incompressible. And so we see then the change in pressure reflected as a change in the volume underneath there. And so as that pressure drops off, that gives us an indication of the air content. In this case, you can calibrate to give you the air content directly. That's what we normally see. In this test now, we're going to, again, fill the bowl the same way, secure the lid with the high-powered clamps. We're still going to put the water into the petcocks there. But instead of pressurizing just one time, we're going to ramp this sucker up. The first pressurization goes up to 14.5 PSI.
That's the blue line is what we're pressurizing that, that chamber to on top. Then we release it, and it equilibrates at some pressure down here. The whole system equilibrates, maybe it drops down to, which shows it being at 9.5 PSI. Then we ramp it up again. We go up to 30 PSI, and again, release it. And one more time, all the way up to 45 PSI, and we release it, and again, it equilibrates. So in these three steps, each step of the way, you're getting different amounts of compression down there depending on the size of the bubbles that are there. At the first step, what do you think? Is it the biggest bubbles or the smallest bubbles that give you the changes of volume at the lower pressures? The bigger bubbles, right? And as we ramp the pressure up, we're starting to have an impact on the smaller and smaller bubbles. So we're getting three different steps along the way, which is giving us a reduction in the volume of increasingly smaller bubble sizes. And we're actually going to do this twice. Run that whole sequence twice, and based on the numbers that you get at each of these stops along the way, you feed that into a little algorithm, and it prints out, it calculates for you what they're calling a SAM number, a super air meter number. And that number is what we are then going to correlate to the air void distribution. You can also use it just for a basic air volume measurement, your standard test that you already do now. So they test the concept here. They did a whole lot of different concrete mixtures in the lab there at Oklahoma State, different combinations of air trainers and cements and different water cementitious ratios, slumped anywhere from a quarter inch, really stiff slip form mix to a 10 inch supercrete, if you will, air contents from very low numbers to very high numbers. And they also did, on each of these mixtures, they cast companion beams and did the linear traverse measurements. And then they compared all these things to that SAM number. And here's what they kind of look like. A lot of scatter looks like someone kind of kept the shotgun down here and blew it out that way. But these are the numbers that, here's our spacing factor of 0.008 that we would traditionally use from hardened air analysis. Here's the SAM number of 0.2, which has become the kind of the de facto guideline. 0.2 correlates to about 0.008. This is our durable region down here. This is our definitely non-durable region out here. These two regions here and here are we've got a little disagreement between the two systems. But you can see that the number of points down here where we're saying a big SAM number still gave us a low spacing factor, or this area where we have small SAM numbers that happen to be correlated with a high spacing factor, those are pretty small areas. You have 90%, 92% of the time, your SAM numbers give you the same kind of indication as your spacing factor. That's pretty good agreement. And they actually ran that with FHWA and with a lot of field data as well. And overall, between different test sites and field and lab, federal highways and Oklahoma State, 90% agreement at that 0.2 level. And if you push on to a 0.25, you can actually ramp that number up even higher. This showed against some different values for different points. So the 0.2 number gives you a pretty good correlation. So, and as I mentioned earlier, this gives you kind of a tool for looking at the impact of that and compatibility. If you're making a change on a job, you want to see, all right, I'm still getting the same air content, maybe the air content even went up, but it might not be as good of an air void system. This gives you a quick way of getting an indication about whether or not you still have an acceptable air void system. Useful tool. A lot of states are trying it out right now. There are a number of these devices that are out on trial right now. Two states, Michigan and Oklahoma, have more or less adopted the device, and it's in their specifications. But there are a number of devices in states. I guess you have some here in Illinois, down in Central Office, I assume. They're making the rounds too much. Anyone know about the Illinois devices here? Doing something. Just in-house trials, basically, or?
Yeah, they're already in the same now, so we have our SAM. We're going to back out, working with two industry partners. We're going with District 4 and District 5, mainly, so far. But have they been up here yet with that device?
Not yet.
Not yet.
Well, it seems to show an awful lot of promise. There's a lot of buzz about this, so it wouldn't surprise me to see it up here in the not-too-distant future. Randy, do you want to add any of this?
Not really. We do have one producer that's out there running around with one, too, so admixture supplier.
Okay.
trying to get a handle on it.
There is now, I think, just approved as of a couple months ago, there is an ASHTO specification, TP 118, temporary specification provision. If you want to learn more about it, or even order one for your side projects, you know, putting sidewalks in on the weekends or something, you want a super air meter, go to this website and you order one. They're about $3,000 for the full kit.
And Mark, I just wanted to reiterate, this is actually a real serious issue for Illinois DOT. I don't want to downplay this. We have one. We have 10. If we had 10 people to run it, we only have one person. This air entrainment for Illinois DOT outside of deep cracking, the second most damaging thing going on in any concrete in Illinois. And air entrainment is not an exact science. And with the admixtures that we have today, I would just stress to anybody that works out there in the field, if you're getting abnormal air or low air, take it extremely serious and be working with your ready mix producer. Because it's not your, there's a good chance it's not your gauge, it's your conduit. And you will see, unfortunately, you will see adverse effects to your concrete very rapidly. Within 10 years, maybe even less. The old days of admixtures with air entrainment, they're gone. That was an example. It always worked. It always, those days are gone.
And there are other things going on. I mean, you can have an air void system. Not to have 5 minutes left to do the last piece here. But, you can have a good air void system. You can infill that air void system. Get secondary entering guide forming. We're finding out now that there's a lot of work being done by Jason Weiss down at Purdue University and Peter Taylor at the CB Tech Center about the interactions between some of the de-icing chemicals we're using, calcium chloride, and particularly the mag chlorides, and the chemistry in the cements, which is giving us a expansive paste reaction. It's very similar to ASR, and it takes place actually at 40 and 50 degrees Fahrenheit. So in the spring, it gets nice and warm out, and we're all happy to be out wandering around and looking at the daisies pushing up. That's when a lot of the damage is being done to the concrete that looks like decracking free slot air. And it isn't even related to the air void system. So there's a lot of stuff going on out there. You could have a good air void system and still have an issue. We're learning more all the time. But certainly you want to have a good air void system, as the gentleman said. Okay, so we've shown that air void volume alone is not enough to determine the quality of the system. This test method looks like it's one that offers some potential for measuring the quality of that system. That 0.2 number seems to be the one that everyone's looking at right now based on more than 300 different lab and field tests at several different sites around the country, and correlates pretty well with the limited number of freeze thaw test results that they've done it on so far. There's Tyler's contact information. He's the expert on the thing. If you want to learn more, go to the website as well. Any questions, comments, or rude remarks about the air void systems? Not even rude remarks. Okay. In the last 3 minutes, this is going to be a real Reader's Digest abridged version here. Okay, that's fine. That's about all I know about it. But CA4PRS, the construction analysis for pavement rehabilitation strategies. Yeah, this was just presented a couple days ago downtown Chicago at the ACK mid-year meeting to talk to Steve and say, that looks like some good stuff I'd like to show the folks at IDOT. This is for you planners. This is the planners' time to shine here. How many of you guys are aware of the CA4PS program? PRS program? Okay. It's one of a handful of tools. There are a few tools that are out there for analyzing the impact of different traffic management strategies. This is one of them. Springs from the fact that we've got aging infrastructure out there. We've got to be doing work. It's not new construction anymore. We're often working under traffic. We have a very loud and vocal and impatient and self-absorbed public. And no one wants to be inconvenienced. They all want the roads fixed, but they don't want it done when they have to drive on, right? And so we're forced with making these tough decisions about working at night in very chopped up pieces of work time. Quality of work often goes down. Safety may go down as a result of this. Whereas if we just shut things down sometimes, a little more pain for a shorter period of time is what we
we find is often the case, and a lot of times the public is accepting of that if you can provide them with backup to say, this is what it's going to be. And we're going to save you, instead of having a 10-month-long project, we're going to make this a 6-week project. Safety is key, with all the injuries, fatalities and work zones around the country. That's kind of old data. Actually, it's dropped off, and I understand it's dropped off quite a bit in the last 10 years here. It's probably about cut in half in the last 10 years. But it's still a significant number. And work zones are responsible for a major portion of our non-recurring traffic delays. Okay? Recurring ones being where you've got lane drops and things like that. We have to write backup and go through lanes up too. But the non-recurring ones, work zones are responsible for probably about 24% of the non-recurring ones. So the purpose of this was to kind of do an analysis that balances these competing objectives. Better quality construction for longer lasting pavements, and yet faster delivery of the construction, tolerable traffic delays, and still doing it inside the agency's budget. And those are often, you change one and the other one goes in the wrong direction. So it was developed, pooled fund study again. California, a big leader on this thing. They were strongly interested, but also Minnesota, Texas, Washington State, Federal Highway Administration. It's not brand new. It's been out there. It was part of the FHWA's Market Ready program put out in 2008. There's been a lot of work being done on implementation and kind of refining it. There's been some expansions to the product that have been done in recent years. They've now got a module in here on precast pavement construction as a part of this, because Caltrans is doing a lot of precast pavement construction, not just repairs like we're doing often here in Illinois and many other places, but they're actually building pavements out of precast on a nightly basis. It is a free group license for any state DOT, so you have access to this for free. We're in the process of making it a web-based system, which I think will make it available for everybody. They do also provide on-site training, and so far it's been distributed to, as you can see, more than 1,000 engineers in 22 different states. It consists of three primary modules, and it's kind of a what if it's an analysis tool. You come into it with your plan, work, your shutdowns, how many lanes you've got, how many you're proposing to close at various times, and it evaluates that for you in three separate modules. One, it gives you an analysis of your schedule. It tells you how long the site duration is going to last under a particular closure scenario. And if that's not acceptable, it kicks you out and says, all right, find a different approach. You're not even getting past stage one. If it passes stage one, then it goes down and looks at stage two, looks at the traffic backups, looks at the lengths of the delays that will result. And again, depending upon the thresholds that you set up for acceptability, 80 minutes, 40 minutes, 20 minutes, 10 minutes maximum delay, whatever those numbers are, if it's acceptable, it drops through to the next one, which is to look at the cost. What is the cost of that traffic control scenario going to be, both in terms of agency costs and in terms of user costs, in terms of user delays, detouring, and things like that. If it passes all three of those, then it drops out the bottom and gives you the guidance to develop your traffic management plan for developing plans and specs and so forth. These are the current CA4 PRS options. Rehabilitation, it's kind of loosely used rehabilitation. It's actually reconstruction. And you're reconstructing one or two lanes at a time as you rebuild the pavement. It's not going out and evaluating if I'm going to do a patch and grind job. That module does not exist. We provided input definition, they say. I think a lot of people get used out of that too, but that wasn't one of the first ones. HMA overlay and HMA mill and fill, pulled up the reconstruction with hot mix asphalt, and I mentioned already precast concrete and road widening. And you can operate it in two different modes. One deterministic, where it uses models and spits out fixed numbers, this many minutes of delay, this much cost. Or you can operate it in a probabilistic mode, where you have to input the averages, the standard deviations on assumed normal distributions of delay times and duration lengths of your activities. And in the end, then it gives you kind of a range of answers. It says, you know, the average is this, but with the standard deviation of this, this is what your traffic delay is going to be, this is what your cost will be, these are the impacts. So you can operate it either way. This is a typical input screen for the first module on scheduling. This was done for an I-15 project in California. This kind of shows you, it's pretty user-friendly. You click on what your construction window is, weekend closures, nighttime closures, continuous closures and continuous operations of work, continuous closures with shift operations, how much curing time you need to have on the concrete in this case, what the section profile is, either a predefined 8, 10, or 12, or you can do things in a user-defined manner. Changes in roadway elevation, lane widths, and then over here you're defining how you're closing your different lanes down at different times. So obviously we don't have time to go into this in detail. But it has been validated on a number of projects. It's been actually implemented on at least 3 major projects. This I-15 DeVore project in California. This shows some of the things that they looked at doing, some of the options they considered, and what the impacts were. These are the numbers that came out. They ran this in a deterministic manner. So their options were one continuous closure, actually operating 24/7. It was one in each direction. So they had, for example, northbound lanes were shut down, then southbound lanes were shut down. Total closure hours, 400. And they predicted that the maximum delay to traffic was going to be 80 minutes. That's a lot of delay. But then you're in California. Maybe that's not so much. I don't know. They did find, I'm told that they found that when they actually did it, because they used this in conjunction with a lot of public awareness, the actual maximum traffic delay is only about 40 minutes because people just self-divert elsewhere. Okay? But the models were predicting about 80 minutes with no diversion. Traffic delay costs to the users, $5 million over the length of the project. Agency cost of $25 million, and total cost was $30 million. That is what they ended up doing, by the way. Compared to their other options, 72-hour weekday closures with nonstop work, 8 closures were required. It was going to increase by 50% of the duration, 576 hours versus 400. 55-hour weekend closures, shutting down Friday night, opening up for Monday morning. It's going to take 16 of those to do the job. That more than doubled, like 880 hours. With, again, that same 80-minute maximum delay on the weekends. And look at the user costs are going through the roof. And also, they're not getting as much production from the contractors, so the contractors' costs are going to go up. That means agency costs are going up. And that was actually the highest total cost to the $41 million versus $30 million. So a 30% increase in total costs. And you get the other scenarios down here as well. Look down here, 7-hour nighttime closures, which was kind of their typical standard. You know, no one wanted to close during the day. We'll close it only at night. 7 hours a night is all you're going to get, which means your effective work time is probably only about 5 hours because you're spending an hour setting up traffic control and an hour tearing it down. 2,900 hours. It was going to be 10 months. This is an example of the output you get when you run it probabilistically. I'm just going to kind of clear through the rest. You get an idea what the tool is about and what it can do. We're kind of running into break time here.
I want to keep you guys. Fast.
Is it 7 minutes fast?
No.
Okay. But at any rate, it does give you, you get an idea of the potential of this tool, and it is being developed and modified kind of on a continuing basis. I took out the slides that showed it's probably been implemented on now about 30 different projects around the country, mostly out in California. They got the biggest traffic issues, but I got to think Chicago can't be all that far. So it is a valuable tool in both the planning stage and the design stage in terms of setting up your closures and your construction staging plans for the contractor, and the construction stage also in terms of kind of helping to identify what the incentives and disincentives might be, what your lane rental fees should be based on the closure times and the traffic delays and things that will result. We kind of help to optimize production rates in the field as well. So they've got a lot of training available. I'm in the process of upgrading both the software and the training. They have online training, which is being developed, which will include case studies. I don't think that's available yet. Right now they're doing on-demand and classroom training only. And all this stuff will be in the next 12 months or so. This will be coming out. So it's a good tool. Call SIVA here at that phone number, probably just write Steve on that phone number, is the easiest way to get a hold of him. And David Lim also works out there at Caltrans, and he's been working closely with this project out there. So those are your primary contacts to learn more about this. And, that's all I've got. So if there are no questions, let's get coffee and snacks. Okay? Thank you.
Technology, the theory is well known, the mixed designs are well established, so we shouldn't be surprised that this is a very good alternative when it comes to repairing concrete pavements and asphalt pavements. Okay. Precast systems have been used for intermittent repairs, and intermittent repairs are really a full depth repairs or a few patches strung together. They've also been used for continuous repairs, and within the continuous repair system, there's the jointed system, which after in place looks just like a jointed pavement, a jointed concrete pavement, or there are also post-tension pre-stress systems. I'm going to focus my presentation really on the jointed system and not on the pre-stress system, but nonetheless, the post-tension pre-stress precast systems have also found a lot of application in the paving industry. And I believe at some presentations that Professor Battenberg has made, I think it was Rockford Airport in Illinois, I think that's where he first tried one of these systems for the airport. So again, it has a long history and a successful history. So again, we are now learning to apply some of the technology that was already been in place 50, 60, 70 years ago. There are genetic systems that have been developed, as well as proprietary systems that have been developed in support of precast paving or modular paving. So this sort of gives it's hard to read. I'll read it for you, but I think you can appreciate the trend. As I said, we started experimenting with precast pavements or modular pavements in the late 90s, early 2000s. And a lot of these projects were experimental projects, you know, real short runs on low volume roads, because we were still trying to figure out whether this technology will work and trying to work out the kinks. But really after about 2005, 2006, we saw a dramatic jump in the application because folks were getting comfortable with this technology. The DOTs were getting more comfortable with this technology, and there were more contractors who could really do this work. There are about, as of 2013 or 2014, there are over 33 lane miles of roads that have received this precast technology, not only in the U.S., but also in Canada. I think it was about 3 or 4 years ago, there was a big project in Indonesia that was done using the post-tension pre-stress system. So it's going beyond the boundaries of North America, and there have been projects done in the Netherlands, in Japan, in France, using various kinds of precast and modular technology. So it is fast getting a lot of attention, not only in North America but also across the world. And projects have included intermittent applications, continuous applications, bridge approaches, and there are many other special applications, and I think Dr. Snyder may have some examples of special applications in his presentation. So again, we've come a long way since experimental and test projects since 2000. So in the U.S., it's been all over the place. I think California, New York, Illinois, I think on the tollway system, there are several examples of these precast applications. Texas has a lot of applications on the post-tension system, but as you can see, there are several places where this modular pavement technology has been applied. In some cases, it has still remained in the experimental state, but in many cases, it's gone beyond that, and it's really a mass production and is considered as one of the alternatives to repair as well as paving with concrete. Here are some examples. I think the Tappan Zee Bridge or the toll plaza at the Tappan Zee Bridge was probably the first success story, and I think it was built in 2001, and it is showing remarkable performance. I think this was probably one of the first ones using the Fort Miller system. But these are some other examples of projects that have since then been constructed. And again, these are just examples. There are many more projects across the country where modular pavements have been used. Some have shown tremendous success and good performance. Some developed some premature cracking, but the reasons were well known as to why those premature cracks showed up. So it wasn't a surprise when we sort of did some forensic work on it. It was obvious saying, duh, we shouldn't have done that. That's what caused some of these failures. So so we can learn from our mistakes. We can learn from the errors that were made and hopefully don't repeat them in the future. But in general, the performance of this technology has been satisfactory. Typical distresses that can be addressed using this technology, and these are all familiar distresses. You can have joint failures, you can have shattered slabs, you can have transverse cracking, longitudinal cracking, just aged pavements, 30, 40, 50-year-old pavements just showing distress. These are all good candidates for the modular pavement technology or the precast paving technology. Yes, you can even repair asphalt pavements. If you have shoving, running, washboarding of the surface, these are all situations where precast pavements can be used to repair the problem. So again, you don't need to look for very special kinds of distresses that would be candidates. These are all distresses that we've seen, and these are all possible candidates for the precast application. So I'll just quickly run down the genetic construction process, and we'll get into the details a little bit later. So essentially, like you would do a full depth repair, you would identify the distressed area, you would mark out the distressed area, saw cut out the distressed area, and then essentially remove the distressed panel. Again, you want to take care that when you're removing the distressed panel, you're not fracturing into multiple slabs, because A, it slows the process down, and you're contaminating the base material, and a lot of cleanup needs to be done before you can prepare the base and bring in the precast panel. So again, you have to be careful when you're removing the distressed panel. You want to remove it in as less number of pieces as you can during the removal process. The base needs to be prepared, or at least regraded if you're going to continue using the existing base. In this case, and then of course you need to drill in the holes for the dowel bars, and then basically the panels are brought in, lowered into the hole, into the excavation, and you're on your way. And the next day, you're ready to open it to traffic, and as if nothing ever happened. So this is sort of the sequence of events that take place during the construction process or the installation of a precast panel. And this is an example of a night job in New Jersey, but there have been many other such projects. As I had mentioned to you earlier, there are several genetic as well as proprietary methods that folks have developed. So this is the Roman stone method, where the dowel slots, as you can see from this picture, are on the top. That is, the dowel slots are on the surface. This is a genetic method that was developed by the Illinois Tollway method, and they did a lot of test sections, did some falling weight deflectometer tests to look at the efficacy of the dowel system and the jointing system. And then this is the Fort Miller system, which is a proprietary method. And the big difference between the Roman stone and the Fort Miller system, and there are many differences, but the obvious difference is the location of the dowel slots. The dowel slots are on the underside of the slab. So when the slab is in place, you don't see any dowel slots, or it doesn't look like a DBR. And there are some advantages to that, because you're protecting the grout from any kind of durability problems. And the failure of that dowel slot grout is not evident. So that is a big advantage over having the slots on the surface versus the slots being on the underside of the slab. Some more recent systems that were developed in California or have been used in California is this Barrett light system, and I encourage you to watch this installation video. It makes for some fascinating viewing, but the key here is the installation of the dowel bars. Let's see. So what happens is that the dowel bar, as you can see, the dowel bar is slid into this hole. The entire 18-inch long dowel bar is slid into the hole. And then when the joining slab is brought in, through these slots, you push the dowel bar, so you have 9 inches of the dowel bar on either slot, on either side. So in this case, again, you don't see the slots for the dowel bars, and that is a good thing from a durability standpoint. What I have seen in the last 4 or 5 years, the technology is pretty much there. We are working on the edges, trying to improve the efficiency and really work on making sure that the joints function well, because that is a key to success for a jointed plain concrete pavement. And a lot of the work has been, a lot of the energy has been focused on efficient installation of the jointing system. That seems to be that seems to be a critical piece, and that will also reduce the installation time. So this is a step in the right direction when it comes to installing dowel bars on site. So I don't mean for you to read this table, but essentially there are multiple ways by which dowel bars and joints are placed in these precast systems. You have sort of the slots on the top that has its own advantages and disadvantages. I think the biggest disadvantage is sort of the durability of the grout that is exposed to freezing and thawing conditions. And then, of course, you have the other systems where the dowel slot is on the underside and the grout is not exposed, so it has little or no durability issues. But I think, to me, those are the critical issues when it comes to the installation of dowel bars and joints in these precast systems. But keys to success. There are many things we need to be careful about and think about, and none of these are new. I mean, if I was to replace this presentation and said conventional jointed pavement, concrete pavements, these are the same keys to success. So I don't think we need to discard what we already know about successful jointed pavement systems. Those are the same things we apply to precast systems, because by no means is a precast system a panacea that, okay, we'll throw in the precast slab and all our problems will go away. Well, that's not going to happen. If you don't pay careful attention to the basics of concrete pavement design and construction. So clearly strength and volume and thermal properties are important. The coefficient of thermal expansion of the concrete is still important. It doesn't change because it's a precast concrete pavement, because the joint spacing is still an element in the design of precast concrete pavements. There is some light reinforcement in these slabs simply for handling and transportation stresses rather than load stresses. So because there is some significant handling and transportation of these panels, a light amount of reinforcement is needed so you don't get pre-cracking or you don't get premature cracking even before installation. I think the load transfer systems are a key, and the success to a jointed system is in the load transfer system and how well your joint works. So I don't think we should forget the fundamentals of the joint load transfer system, as well as the materials of the dowel bar. Corrosion still happens in precast systems too. So if there are alternative materials that can be used in dowel bars to prevent or minimize or mitigate the corrosion issues, well, those should be considered. So again, everything that we know about conventional jointed pavement concretes and dowel bars, those should be considered in this. And Dr. Snyder is going to talk about some other innovations in shorter dowel lengths, and embedment lengths, and so these are all innovations that have been spurred from this technology, and they can find its way even in conventional paving. So I think we're learning from precast pavements over to conventional paving, and from conventional paving over to precast. It's almost like a technology transfer between these two concrete paving types. So that's important to consider. Panel thicknesses are important, because if you have, they're really critical in precast, because if you have very heavy panels, transportation and hauling and installation becomes a challenge. You need much larger cranes, and sometimes the constraints of the construction prevent you from having large cranes. You may have overhead power lines and you can't have very high cranes because of the interference between the boom of the crane and the overhead power line. So you have to be careful how thick and how big or the physical dimension of these panels are, because weight does become an issue when it comes to precast panels. The support system is important. The success of a concrete pavement is the uniform support system. You don't want voids under your pavements, because if you have non-uniform support, you can cause a lot of, you can cause a lot of problems in the concrete pavement. We know this. We shouldn't ignore that when it comes to precast or modular pavement. So uniformity of support is very critical. Feasibility, and not all projects lend themselves to the precast or modular application, even though it may be a structurally viable alternative. And again, those have to be considered. Access to the site is a very important element when you are using precast or modular pavements. Sometimes, even though the modular pavements might be the way to go, the access to the site may lead to changing the alternative and using something else to repair the concrete pavement. So again, those are important things. The contractor needs contractors who can do this. Believe you me, contractors who can do conventional paving not necessarily can do precast paving if they don't have the experience. So that's important. The contractor training is important. Having the specifications is very important, that the contractor can work off, the engineers can work off. So these are things that need to be considered before considering the use of precast pavements or modular pavements. If these things fall in place, the chances of a successful installation become very high, and the long lives can sort of endure from there. So again, I'm going to focus on a few keys to success. I've sort of given you a big laundry list of things to look at, but I want to emphasize on a few things that precast pavements are not a panacea to all problems. If there is a drainage problem, the precast pavement is not going to fix it. You have to fix the drainage problem first. Simply by slapping on a slab is not going to, it covers the problem, it doesn't remove the problem. So then there are telltale signs. You can look at the distress, and it tells you a lot about why that pavement failed the way it failed. And there's a pretty good chance that if drainage is the culprit, while the drainage will remain to be an issue, simply slapping on the slab is not going to do it. Looking at the surrounding pavements, that can tell you a story as to what's going on. So again, you have to, independent of the installation system, independent of whether it's a jointed system or a pre-stressed system, you have to sort of look at the problems you're trying to address. And if you don't fix the root cause of the problem will come back. And if you remember in the second slide I showed you, long lives are not going to come out of this if the fundamental problems are not fixed. So drainage, base, type of distress indicate underlying issues, and what the adjoining pavements are showing in terms of distress. That's important. Slab removal is a critical piece because when you remove the slab, if you damage the base, especially if it's a cement treated or a lean concrete base, there's very few things you can do to remedy that base. If you gouge out a big piece of the cement treated base, now you've created a void. You can say, well, I can backfill it with sand. No, you can't, because if you do, now you've got dissimilar materials supporting the slab. So especially when you have treated bases, cement treated and lean concrete bases, you have to be really careful when removing the distressed slab, because as I said, damaging the base can set you back tremendously when it comes to short construction windows. You also don't want to damage the adjoining pavement, because if you damage the adjoining pavement, now you've bought yourself more trouble than you had bargained for. So removing the slabs is also a very critical operation in guaranteeing the success of these precast projects. So again, I can't overemphasize how important it is and how important it is to be careful when removing existing and damaged slabs. As I said, the uniformity of support is critical. There have been a host of base materials. You can obviously encounter granular bases, asphalt-treated bases, lean concrete bases, cement-treated bases. Pervious concrete has been used in some projects in Delaware. before the concrete slab was placed on it. You can have rapid setting lean concrete bases. These are all base materials that have been used and have been encountered in the different projects that I've shown you on the map. And then, of course, you can use different bedding materials to make sure, to ensure the elevations are matched with the surrounding pavements. Granular materials have been used, cement grouts, and in some instances, high-density polyurethane has been used to meet the elevation requirements all along. So, but again, the uniformity piece is very critical, making sure that the base is not disturbed prior to the placement of the precast panel. That's extremely important to the success of this system. Slab dimensions, and as I one big deal about slab dimensions is the weight, because you have to transport, install, and haul this slab over to the job site. So the weight needs to be very critical, because that determines how big your crane should be. So that's important, because that feeds into the ease of transportation, handling, and installation, and also trying to reduce handling stresses. You want to make sure you're managing the aspect ratios between the length and the width of the slab, because again, if the aspect ratios are too big, you can generate stresses and cause premature cracking in the concrete pavements. Again, this is again no different. Our in jointed plane concrete pavements, the spacing is about 15 feet. The width of the slab is 12 feet, so you're looking at 1.25 or so of an aspect ratio. Well, that's how where you should be even for precast concrete. So if those are the dimensions of your repair. So we shouldn't be violating some of the basic principles of those aspect ratios. Otherwise, we are buying stresses that we weren't looking for in the beginning. Early on, we learned that measuring twice and cutting once is very applicable to precast pavements, because they're very unforgiving. You get a slab and you have a hole and the thing doesn't fit. And you got 3 hours before you have to open this road to traffic. Now what? And it is a mess. Now I think the dimensioning is becoming more and more sophisticated, but early on, I've been on projects where you reach the end of the run and you've got a hole that's 3 feet wide because we just didn't have the right dimensioning, and now you're going to slap on cord patch for the night so that you can open it to traffic and then come back again and then fuss with it. So tolerances are extremely unforgiving in precast panels, and you have to be very careful when it comes to dimensioning and measuring the excavation as well as what it is that you're delivering to the job site. So I think everything else can be handled, but this is extremely critical because on-site adjustments are very difficult to make when something rigid is delivered to the job site. Dowel bars, again, the same logic. You want to make sure you avoid any kind of misalignment, and Robert is going to be talking about misaligned dowel bars and its impact on performance of concrete pavements later on today in the afternoon. But again, we shouldn't forget that information, that misaligned dowel bars are not going to do us any good in precast pavements. Using alternative materials that are corrosion resistant or would reduce the onset of corrosion or completely remove corrosion. So that is important. This picture here you see at the bottom, this is one of the experimental precast panels we had in Michigan in 2003, that there was significant deterioration of the dowel grout. It was just a durability problem. The panel in itself was not exhibiting any distress, but the grout was just, this backfill just completely was destroyed in a very short period of time. Again, this was in the beginning when we were still trying to figure this technology out. But this is important. You really don't want your pavements to look like this in a short period of time. But we've come a long way to when it comes to this grout technology. And here there is this picture of the Fort Miller system, where of course the slot is on the bottom side or the underside of the slab, so you really don't have this issue anymore. But again, you've got to be careful when it comes to backfilling of the slot. So the purpose of dowel bars and a good joint design is to minimize deflections, maximize load transfer efficiency, but I would hang my hat on minimizing deflections, because load transfer efficiency can be manipulated. You can have high deflections and you can still have a high load transfer efficiency, but if you minimize the relative deflections across the joint, then that is a good indication of a good performing joint. And again, of course, the dowel bar materials. So there are a lot of resources. These are just some examples of resources. The R05 project, which was on precast concrete pavement, was completed about 2 or 3 years ago. So the Sharp 2 report is online. The state-of-the-art report put out by FHWA on precast concrete pavements is available. And then the CP Tech Center, I think Dr. Snyder was one of the authors, or maybe the only author, on load transfer devices and guides to load transfer devices and tie bars in concrete pavement. So I think that is a worthwhile resource to look at, and I'm sure there are many others that that you can Google and download and look at. I want to leave you with this last thought. We cannot discard the systems approach criteria here. We cannot have a cafeteria approach that you grab one thing from one spec and one thing from other spec and then slap them together and keep your fingers crossed and hope everything's going to work, because the chances are it will not work. You've got to think this through. You have to understand what is the interdependency of construction features, design features, material features, and structural features. These are all, they all play a part in building concrete pavements, and they're no different when it comes to precast or modular pavements. So again, if you took nothing away from this, this is a takeaway that you've got to keep your eyes focused on the systems approach rather than a cafeteria approach to pavement design construction. Do want to acknowledge a whole bunch of folks, Fort Miller Company, Dr. Snyder for helping out with a lot of the slides, some of the photographs you've seen here, Dr. Shiraz Tayabji for sharing some of the presentations he's made all over the country, and Sharp and PCI. With that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Snyder to continue with the presentation.
Thanks, Neeraj. There are other resources also. The National Precast Concrete Association has recently hired me and Peter Smith from the Fort Miller Company to write a manual on jointed precast pavement installations. Neeraj showed you these books back here, and I think this one that FHWA put out. It purports to be about all types, but it does tend to focus on the pre-stressed post-tension systems. That's kind of where the main emphasis is. And NPCA felt that there was a gap there for the jointed system, which are far and away the more common systems to be applied. So look for that by the end of the year. There was also a series of joint webinars that were done between NPCA and the American Concrete Pavement Association in 2014 and 2013. There were 5 webinars, 2 to 3 hours long each, that covered everything from planning to design to construction to specifications to the whole 9 yards. And those were all recorded webinars, and I believe they are available through NPCA and also through the American Concrete Pavement Association on their website. So those can be viewed as well. And they featured an international bunch of folks, a national bunch of folks, national bunch of folks from all over the country talking about different aspects. DOT folks, contractors, designers, manufacturers, so you've got input from all those folks. Those are some really good resources that are out there. And my presentation here is, Neeraj has kind of given you the fundamentals about precast pavement installation, and we are aware that obviously the tollway has been doing a lot of this work recently, and now District 1, Abdul says that you guys have been, got your toes in the water here, and are doing a couple of projects. So we know that you're familiar with a bit of the technology. Neeraj has gone over some of the fundamentals, but I'm going to tell you a little bit about some of the things that are happening to further improve the technology going forward here. Neeraj kind of already covered the why, so I don't need to do this again. Short work windows, long-lasting construction, quicker installation, and so forth. What I want to talk about are some of these newer concepts, and in terms of the actual features of the precast pavement, these are the three I'm going to touch on. Shorter dowels, shorter tie bars, and vertical placement of those dowels. We'll talk about the reasons why on every one of these things as we go along. Panel leveling techniques, Neeraj touched on this. The use of reusable precast paving panels, what's being called RUPS, R-U-P-S, Removable Urban Pavement Systems. Fort Miller's got one, folks over in France have got one, they're very different, and they serve a particular purpose, and you may find that you have a use for something like that someday. And we'll look at some of the innovative installations and applications, what's being called incremental reconstruction using precast pavements. We'll look at an airfield installation or two, and then some new things that are just coming out now and just being designed and built. Unbonded concrete overlay of an asphalt pavement using precast pavement up in Canada. Embedded sensors, plug and play. You got loop detectors, you got weigh in motion things. These things are being cast into and built into precast units. Drop it into the pavement, plug it in, you're off to the races. And then electrified roadways as we move forward into more hybrid vehicles using inductance charging systems to charge first buses and mass transit vehicles on the fly with embedded inductance loops in the pavement, and then more and more that even with cars and passenger cars and things. So that's what's coming. So let's look at the first topic here on reduced slot length. And the question is, why? Who cares? Why worry about slot length? Well, as we're going to see here, and I think Neeraj showed this picture earlier. It's kind of nice with the Fort Miller system. You can look, pick up the bottom and see what you got before you install it. We got slots coming in. These are tie bar slots in from the side. They're usually the length of the tie bar plus an inch or so. Same thing for the dowel bars. You got an 18-inch long bar. You got at least a 10-inch long slot there. And there's potential we've seen on some jobs where, I mean, your slab is kind of weak in the corner here, right? You got a slot cut that and a slot cut that. We've only got maybe 4 or 5 inches of concrete above those slots in a pin. We have seen... I got in here. I don't have it. We've seen some places where cracks have formed. When you see cracks in precast pavements, they almost always line up with the slots. And that's a crack initiation point. Even after you fill those slots with grout, for whatever reason, it's a point where the cracks tend to initiate. And as Neeraj pointed out, a lot of times you got 0.2 to 0.4% steel in both directions, you know, in these things. So the cracks aren't going to go anywhere necessarily, but still we get upset when we see cracks. It's not supposed to behave that way. So if we can shorten these slots and maybe even push them down a little bit and make it so that the web on top, because again, if you get your dowel bars at mid-depth, your slot has to be mid-depth plus half the diameter of your dowel bar plus another half inch to an inch to provide the ability to get grout above it or below it, you've taken a pretty good chunk of meat out of that panel. So if we can shorten the slots and push the slots down, do we need to be at mid-depth? Turns out we don't. And we've known this kind of stuff for a long time. You go back to the 1950s, Keller and Cashel doing work at the Bureau of Public Roads, the predecessor to the Federal Highway Administration. This was on new pavement design, but they were looking at, you know, how much embedment you really need to have on a dowel bar to make it effective. And this was showing their measurements of dowel looseness as a function of diameters of dowel embedment here. And you can see that no matter what, they're looking at 3/4, 1, and 1 1/4 size dowel bars. They weren't so bold as to look at the inch and a half bars that we currently use everywhere now. But on almost all of those, once you got more than about 4 diameters of dowel embedment, what they're calling dowel looseness, which is really a measure of differential deflection across their joints, and these were all with, by the way, 3/4 inch wide joints, which is what we sometimes see on precast pavements. We don't see that wide often on new pavements, but it's actually a pretty good representation of what we may have on some precast jobs. More than 4 diameters of embedment, no real benefit. So why do we get these 18-inch long bars? In new construction, we have 18-inch long bars a lot of times because, you know, conservatism, we're all engineers, we want to be conservative, no one wants to have a failure on their watch. Plus, we've also got variability in the placement of the bars and variability in the saw cut and so forth. But in precast systems or any patching system where we've got the joint, we're installing the dowel bar, we know right where that joint is, we know right where the dowel bar is. We can track how much is embedded on both sides. We really don't need to use 18-inch long bars. In fact, we're seeing a lot of folks are moving away from that. New York State DOT now is using 14-inch long bars on their precast repairs and on their patches in pavements. This is some work that, where'd Dr. Love go? Dr. Zanovich is around here someplace. He did some work under the NCHRP 1069 study, lab work, where he was looking at various lengths of dowel embedment. And what you're seeing here is, you know, 9 inches of embedment, 6 inches of embedment, 4 inches of embedment, they've all got basically the same behavior, the same stiffness of the system. Well, they peak out at different amounts of maximum load, but even the 4-inch of embedment's got 7,000 pounds of load carrying capacity. Your critical dowel bar under a heavy vehicle load probably doesn't carry more than about 3,000 pounds on a bad day. And a lot of times it's more like 2,000 pounds. in shear across that joint, because it gets, the load gets sheared across all the dowel bars, a lot of it goes down into the foundation. So we got plenty of load carrying capacity, and as long as we got at least 4 inches, we got the same kind of behavior. Even down here, 3 inches of embedment and 2 inches of embedment, we got plenty of load carrying capacity. We got a little more deflection, a little more tilt taking place, because you don't have as much of a cantilever there, because you're not anchored as deeply. But we've got cases, you know, Minnesota, got a pavement, they accidentally built the test section and ended up with the saw joints were misplaced, new construction, and they only had 2 inches of embedment. They didn't know that until they went up and scanned the joint, because the load transfer numbers were still pretty good. This is up on Interstate 94 up near the border with North Dakota. So we know we can have less embedment. We don't like necessarily see 2 inches, but we can get by with less than 9. So that provides us a justification. Lev and his students are also doing some work, doing some finite element analyses, and this showed they're looking at using 1-inch dowel bars and only 5 inches of embedment, and looking at the bearing stresses. That's where we're always concerned about bearing stress and failing the concrete around the dowel bar. The peak bearing stress in this case was 2,700 psi, which is about a 10% increase over the 9-inch embedment. Okay, so that bearing stress goes up. We still have the load carrying capacity, and we may still have decent load transfer, but our bearing stresses do go up. We need to watch that. Usually with our bigger bars, again, it's not a concern, but it is something to be aware of. But clearly, we can use shorter bars and shorten those slots up. And the recommendations out of that dowel guide that Neeraj showed you a bit ago is that for round metallic bars, we want to have a minimum of 4 inches of embedment on each side of the joint. Now, it doesn't mean I'm encouraging you all to go out and start ordering 8-inch dowel bars for your patches or anything else, although I think you probably could do so. Certainly not for new construction, where you got some... You still don't know where that joint is exactly. It's nice to have a little longer bar out there, but maybe we can save a little bit of money. Sustainability, maybe we don't need to have 18-inch long dowels out there. If we can control the quality of construction, maybe 14-inch long bars. And Minnesota's been doing 15-inch long bars for 20 or 30 years now. Standard construction is 15-inch bar in Minnesota. In other states, the trend is to go in that direction. Shorten things down, and we've got the dowel alignment measuring devices. Robert's going to talk about that this afternoon. We can get a better handle on this stuff now and tighten it down, and maybe we can use some shorter bars, save some money, or spend that money differently, use it on higher quality bars with better corrosion resistance, whatever. Certainly, though, in precast installations and patching where we know exactly where the joint is, we do not need an 18-inch long bar. We're throwing our money away. Same thing is true for tie bars. We typically design our tie bar length to be such that it will develop the full capacity of that tie bar. Your embedment length is a function of the diameter of the tie bar. The bigger diameter you use, the longer the bar has got to be to develop its capacity, right? But do you actually use that full load? I mean, and how many bars you use in here in Illinois in a 15-foot panel? How many bars you got in that longitudinal joint? 3, 4, 5, 5, okay. 30 inches apart, roughly. That's fairly common. But the practice varies so widely. Until a couple of years ago, Ohio was putting 9. They had 9 bars in. If you go over to Germany, they've got 2 in a 4.6-meter panel. And their joints aren't opening up either. You know, so maybe we don't need quite as many of those as we've used historically. And certainly, we don't need to develop that full capacity. If you do an analysis of the lateral forces that are holding these things in place, we're not coming anywhere near to using the full capacity of those tie bars. But people want to make sure they got that capacity, but we'd like to have shorter slots. So how do we do that? Well, these headed tie bars, these two-part headed tie bars are one approach. These are only, you know, order of any length you want. Dayton Superior makes this particular model, but it's only 6 or 7 inches long, same diameter as a number 6 bar or a number 5 bar, like I said, a variety of sizes. And with the head on the end there, you develop a much larger shear failure cone there, which gives you the capacity that you need to get a full 22,000 pounds of pullout with only 6 inches of embedment. Now we can shorten that slot down too. Now we don't have that interference at the corners that makes for that weak corner and maybe makes for a corner break to come out. Here's another benefit is you can see with the two-part system, I mean, you can get it as one big long bar and embed it, but if we do it as a two-part system and we embed in the precast the female part of it, if you will, now we can ship a wider panel out to the field. If we got a 12-foot wide shipping limitation and you got 18 inches of steel hanging on one side, your panel's only going to be 10.5 feet wide. We can use the full 12-foot shipping length if we put this two-part deal in there and we get out the field, we screw this other part in place. Okay, so that's got benefits in terms of shipping and handling larger panels, more efficiency and that sort of thing. So that's a good thing. So the potential savings come from, we shorten the slots, we're also shortening up the amount of hardware grout that we're pumping down into these slots. That's a material cost, we're saving that. We're saving steel. Steel costs are usually paid for by the pound. So you use a shorter bar, fewer pounds, we're saving money there, reduced fabrication costs. It all adds up. Also helps in terms of reinforcing the panels. If I've got, you know, particularly a slot in the top or the bottom, I maybe lay a bar of steel across the top of that slot or underneath the slot, depending on which system I'm using, but I certainly can't run one through the slot. So I've got kind of a discontinuity in my steel reinforcing. My first bar is held back here beyond the end of that slot. If I use a shorter slot, I can bring my bar out closer to the edge where the loads are critical, right, where the higher stresses are going to be. So it gives us a benefit from a structural standpoint as well, to use shorter slots. We can push those bars down. There is nothing magic about having your dowel bar or your tie bar at mid-depth. Concrete pavement does not know the difference. It carries the load in shear across that bar. There's a bending moment. And as long as you've got enough capacity in shear above or below that bar to carry the load, you're golden. Okay? If you've got bars floating all over the place, that's an indication you may have a quality control problem in construction of new pavements. But for a precast system, again, I had that weakened point here. These are all potential weakened points, particularly if I'm putting the slabs in place on night one, opening up the traffic as we often do, and then coming back and grouting on the second night. Okay? On that first night or that first weekend when it's not fully grouted, I've got relatively high stresses and potential points for crack initiation with these slots. Push the bars down, and I've strengthened that corner up now. And that's also a help. 3 inches of cover is kind of the minimum. I think Jeff said in his presentation, talking about having 2.5. Really only need about 2. We like to say 2.5 or 3, just again, we're engineers too. We like this, you know, little safety factor. We don't want anything going bad on our watch either. But you will have plenty of shear capacity, and Dr. Gozanovich's research has shown that as well. So that's it on the dowel bar stuff. Positioning the panels, and again, Neeraj talked about a little bit of this, great positioning. If you've got grade-supported panels, where you're going to set it down on a prepared, highly accurately graded foundation, there have been improvements in the rails that they often set along the sides of these patches. They'll put these rails along the side and move a shutter screed on wheels that ride on those rails. The rails are set to the proper grade, and you run this screed down the middle and you kind of trim off the bedding material that way. There have been improvements made that way. There's also laser-controlled grading equipment out there now. Somero makes some laser-controlled grading equipment, very accurate, not useful on individual repair, but if you have a long area, you have several panels in a row, operating that shuttle screed and pushing that material down 100 feet worth of a patch can be kind of tough. And the contractor might get a little lazy, and it might tilt that screed back and let a little lump pass. Now you got an area with bad support. Big areas are well handled with these laser grading equipment. And the use of cement-treated bedding material. We're seeing a lot of that being done out in California. And they say it never rains in Southern California, but the Southern California people, they're afraid of water. And if you put an unbounded granular material underneath this material, typical cement sand or stone sand, they're concerned about that washing out. So they take one part cement, six parts stone sand, and they lay that out there dry. And they grade that. And just before they put the panel on top, they may or may not bless it with a little bit of water, turn a little light sprinkler on things, just kind of initiate it. Even if they don't, you're going to get moisture and condensation accumulate under there. Within about a week or so, that stuff's set up, and it's 3,000 or 4,000 pounds compressive strength. And that gives them both the immediate ability to support these panels, but long-term strength and erosion protection as well, and they like that. So those are things that are being done. Leveling screw positions and shims. I got pictures of some of this stuff. Neeraj showed the Gracie lift system. There are 3 or 4 different varieties that are out there. Patterson Bolt, we got a system, and there's kind of a generic one. But these are all embedded in the slabs to start with. This stage of the time of having to do all the repairs to that foundation. Neeraj mentioned about, you know, maybe tearing up that foundation with a little bit of repair work. It's not real even. You don't want to take the time to spread that bedding material out. What they do then is they put these panels in with this combination lifting device. So they're actually using the top side of it, is open to the top. They'll attach their cabling to the crane, and they'll lift it into place. Then they remove that part, and then they can attach a, an air hammer that goes onto a hex nut on top of here, and that drives this threaded shoe up or down, and they can actually lift the panel to the proper elevation, and then inject their grout underneath to fill whatever the void is. So in terms of design, these panels are always designed about a half an inch thinner than what the surrounding pavement is, because you have to have room for that shoe to drop down and lift the grout underneath and so forth. But these are, again, kind of an innovation, and we're seeing a lot more of this because it does take away the time in the field that's required for placing and leveling that bedding material. And California's big into that. Here's a shot with the drill in place, and he's, you know, raising it up. If you don't go to one corner and raise it all the way up, it's an iterative process. You can't raise any one leg too much, you crack the panel that way. You have little bits all the way around, you know, iterative process. But it works. It's a cool process. Shims and grouts, airfield pavements. This was, I think this is the only place I know of that it's been done. I've heard it proposed for a few places. They did it at LaGuardia Airport on an airport apron. They surveyed this entire apron area and determined where the elevation of the slabs needed to be, what the elevation of the ground was underneath at the lift points for the panels, and then they had very hard rubber, high durometer rubber pads or shims that were placed and surveyed into location at all the critical lift points for these panels. These are pretty good sized panels, as you can see here too. This goes to the weight issue that Neeraj was talking about, 12 and a half feet wide by 25 feet long. That's a really heavy panel, particularly when you get out to airport thicknesses and you're 15 to 20 inches thick. You have really tall cranes. And it's hard to haul things that are that big. They worked at LaGuardia because they were able to actually fabricate them and ship them down the river by barge and then haul them out of the river right near the airport. LaGuardia is on the river. So one of those things they can do that you may not be able to do everywhere. But again, going to Neeraj's comments about panel size and handling, they had some really tall cranes, and they had to light them and stuff because you're on an airport. You don't like tall things at airports. That's often a bad idea. So shims are done. That's an airport installation. And I think we haven't seen much work with precasted airports, but I think we're going to. There have been a few jobs. You get into that bullseye area where you got runways that cross. When you need to replace that, and you're shutting down operations on two facilities, overnight with precast starts to look pretty good. Again, you're going to pay attention to the panel sizes and the cranes are involved. And, you know, fabricate them on site or whatever, but I think you're going to see some things moving in that direction eventually. Okay, there's another, that's the application there. Okay, let's talk about those removable pavement systems. Same kinds of things as we have out on your highways here. You may also have on your city streets, intersections, rutted pavements, rutting and shoving at the intersections. Very busy intersections, hard to shut them down. And of course, what's the first thing you do anytime, particularly in cities? Anytime they build a new road through a city, first thing that happens about 6 months later, oh, the utility's got to come through and they want to upgrade now. Right? That never happens. Or even if it doesn't happen right away, eventually it's going to happen. So having the ability to access underneath the pavement is kind of a unique thing with precast. If we can remove that panel, let them do their work, then instead of having to come back and put hot mix back in there and that ruts and shoves and settles down in it. What if we could put our precast panels back in there? We can reuse those precast panels. There's no curing time involved. You know, there's no asphalt to run and shove. Could be a kind of a cool thing, right? So there have been a few of those systems. Might need to do a different battery deal here. We'll see.
I got a laser. I don't know what the problem is. The laser works.
This is slow now?
Yeah. Okay. Here's a system that was developed in France. This has been around for a while. It's kind of a cool system, isn't it? Hexag. Oh, now it's working. It works like crazy now. Push the wrong damn button. Of course, it takes up. Now, laser pointer now. Forward. Okay, here we go. Once more. Back it up. Okay. There we go. Laser. There it is. Okay. A hexagonal plate system lifted into place with a vacuum type system, and then they use this little gentle persuader to kind of knock it into place there. Now, I didn't do that. I guess we're done talking about that. But they're doing that, and I just saw an article in an international publication where Belgium is doing a lot of those. That same design, they borrowed it from France and using it for these big plaza areas. It kind of looks cool. It's artsy. It's, you know, it's French, right? So Here's the American version. Fort Miller's got a super paver, what they're calling super paver. Everything is Fort Miller super. It's super paved, it's a super dowel, it's a super paver. The idea here is, though, it's a small removable system. These are 6x6 panels, and it's made possible. Made possible by this super dowel, which is a hollow dowel. Yes, we can use hollow dowels. We're seeing hollow dowels being used in some states for dowel bars, and New York's using them right now. I did not push that. I didn't, and it shouldn't be on a timer either. All right. There's a super dowel. Just bear with me, please. Okay. Once more forward. I've caught up with it now. Come on. Okay, there's the hollow dowel, and you can see it's got a hex nut in both ends of the thing. It's hollow in the middle. It's your standard 18-inch long bar. This is a stainless steel product, by the way. And what happens is, when you're ready to take it out, you cut around the perimeter of this patch, cut right through the hollow dowel. That's why you want it hollow, for two reasons. One, it's easier to cut through, and two, because you can then remove it. You insert a threaded rod through the hex nut in the end there, and again, attach an air wrench to the end of it, or you can, if you got grad students, you can have them do it manually. And you back this thing out. As you run that rod through the nut, the dowel bar backs out. Okay? This is out of the side that's being left in place. You back that side out. That can then be reamed and insert grout and plug a new dowel bar back into there. On the patch side, and I just did click it again. I click it twice. On the patch side, okay, so this is the part that we just talked about. We backed the dowel out of there, we reamed it out, put new dowel bars back in. We take the patch out 6x6, we pull it out, flip it over on its back like a turtle, and we take lightweight jackhammers and we chip out the grout from those slots. And it usually comes out fairly easily. Okay? And then you can drop that back into place again. You can reuse that same panel. So sustainable, good access, in and out, quick in and out for repairs, no curing time. It's a good thing all the way around. They're doing this. They're doing about a mile of this right now. They're reconstructing Broadway Junction. Downtown New York City is being done right now with this product. About a mile long of all 6x6 pavers. They're doing it overnights, an overnight installation. So they do it at night when no one's around and putting this stuff back in. So that'll be the first major project done that way. Advantages, relatively lightweight. Each of those panels is only 2 tons. So you can use small equipment to handle them. You don't need big cranes. You're only taking out what's needed. Precast slabs are relatively forgiving. You know, if you put hot mix into a trench, it's going to tend to settle in if they don't do a great job of compacting it. Concrete, to an extent, is going to bridge a lot of that stuff. If it does crack, then we got that heavy reinforcing to hold the cracks tight. Relatively small footprint. Keeps your street appearance the same. It's reusable. It's sustainable. It's green. And they're small panels, so they're all flat panels. You can keep them in stock. I think that's the New York City DOT's plan, is they're going to have a bunch of these things on hand, in stock, and they'll be able to, with their own maintenance forces, go out and plug them in. Okay, and advance, please. Thank you. Precast pavement add-ons. I'm going to wrap this thing up here with precast pavement add-ons. The incremental construction, this is also New York Thruway is doing this. They've got some sections of pavements that need to be reconstructed. They're going to need to be reconstructed. Right now, they've got just some individual joints and panels that they're replacing, but they don't anticipate being able to shut this roadway down. So they're replacing the panels they need to right now, and they expect it in, it's jumping ahead again. There we go. So these are the ones they would do this year, and then at some future time, it's expected that the concrete surrounding the ones they did this year will start to deteriorate, so they'll replace those. Then somewhere else down the road, they'll start replacing the ones in between those. And over a period of 10 or 20 years, they may end up actually, in effect, reconstructing the pavement. Just a few precast panels at a time. And without a lot of major disruption to the traveling public. So, again, started on the New Rochelle project on the New York Thruway in 2014. Okay, forward, please. Another taxiway example. There are some applications on airfield pavements. Some done at Dulles Airport as well. Let's go ahead and screen through this. Unbonded, these are real quick slides now. These are things that aren't in place yet, but they're starting to happen. And an unbonded concrete overlay slash inlay of a heavily traveled pavement around Toronto. It's a collaborative effort between the Ministry of Transportation in Ontario, University of Waterloo. They're instrumenting some of the panels Dr. Susan Tig and her students are involved with that. Fort Miller Company is involved, Cement Association of Canada, Golder Associates is their construction, their consultant, and I'm consulting with Fort Miller Company on it. So tentatively looking at 12 by 12 by 8 inch thick precast panels going in on a milled asphalt pavement surface, milling it down to 9 inches. They've got about 13 inches out there. They're going to drop these panels in and basically do an inlay over the entire pavement over a period of about 3 months, a couple miles long and 3 lanes wide. So planned construction later this fall. The nice thing about precast is it's a lot less weather sensitive than new construction is. Here's the instrumented stuff. And again, this is on the New York Thruway here. Way in motion panels and loop detectors for easy pass being used. Dropping them in plug and play. Nothing other than an overnight closure, no real impacts on traffic flow. And then next slide, please. This shows way in motion panels being built in the lab and then being placed on I-95. Same kind of a thing. Everything is done in the fabricator's facility and then plugged and played into the field. Next slide, please. And then this is the electrified roadways concept, which we're seeing. This is some work being done over in Europe. The Germans are doing it. The Belgians are doing it. This is kind of the German system that they're involved with. They've got a series of inductance loops at key points in the pavement surface. As their electric bus is going across, they've got the plates on the bottom that drive across the loops in the pavement underneath, and the passing through the inductance field charges the batteries on those things. Next slide, please. The Belgians are doing it a little bit differently. I've got to just click and tell all the pictures. I think there's two more clicks, please. Oh. One more. Okay. This is experimental for them, and they're not using precast on this yet, but they plan to. They're demonstrating it here. This is going to be, again, a bus facility where the buses come in to park at night, and they run across these inductance loops and sit on that, and it charges them overnight. They're also putting these on uphill grades to give the buses an extra boost in battery power as they're going up these grades and consuming a lot of power, and then they coast on the downhill side. So we're seeing a lot of cool things being done with instruments and things like that in precast panels that would be very difficult to do in the field in normal construction. So final slide, I think. So that's what I've got on new and interesting things with precast pavements. I'm the only thing standing between you and your drinks and your lunch, but I'll take a question or two if you got them.
Yeah, back to conventional panels.
Yeah.
In Illinois, we have a maximum tolerance between panels and a half inch.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit more about how critical that is to maintain that and the long-term durability if you exceed that?
All right, the question has to do with the tolerance. And this is a tolerance on your joint width, your transverse joint width of a half an inch. That's fairly typical. That's your maximum allowable is a half an inch. And with most of these systems, as you're injecting your grout or your fill material underneath, it's going to come up and it's going to fill that up, right? If you got a zip strip type of a foam that you're putting across the top, do you reseal those also?
We do seal them.
Okay. Been involved and done some analyses on a few jobs where you had panels that were installed a little short. It really comes back to the basics of concrete pavement behavior and the bearing stresses and things. As your joint gets wider, your bearing stresses do increase, but they don't increase by all that much. The biggest thing is just kind of keeping things lined up, and once you place them and you inject your grout and it fills in there, it's probably not going to go anywhere anyway. I don't see any issues with durability. I've seen a couple jobs where it slipped out to 3/4 of an inch to an inch. You got impacts on noise. And vehicles getting a little ka-thunk as you go across it. But in terms of the performance of the panel, I've seen nothing that indicates that it shortens the life of the panels at all when you get too long. We don't like to see it. And you need to have some gap there. I mean, there's always a shim there during installation. You have to have some room for them to get this thing dropped into place. So usually we're at least 1/4 of an inch, and we'd like to hold it to a half. But if it gets a little wider than that here and there, you know, it's more of a correct your process thing than a remove and replace type of a thing.
So what would be your opinion if they started to exceed an inch? Yes.
Why are they exceeding an inch? Are the panels fabricated too short? Were they not marked out properly for installation on the pavement? Why?
Well, we feel it's a combination of those issues. So we get panels replaced.
Yeah.
But is that necessary? Or is that acceptable?
Again, From a structural standpoint, it's probably going to be okay. From a functional standpoint, you're going to have wheel slap. You're going to have more potential for stuff to get down in there and cause damage in the future. You know, so it's not an immediate issue. It's not desirable, though. Depends on the nature of the facility and how much risk you can allow on that particular facility of these kinds of potential future things taking place. But structurally, I'd say structurally, it probably is not an issue structurally. Even at an inch, it's not an issue structurally. But the long-term function of the pavement may be compromised.
Is there a cost comparison for modular and conventional?
Cost comparison between modular and conventional? And yeah, that's a real hard thing to... You got to make sure you're comparing apples and apples when you do that. Because if you look at a lot of your rapid set installations, a lot of the precast modular stuff is bid out kind of on an installed basis. It's like, this is it, installed. And with your conventional, instead of saying, well, it's $150 a square yard to build it, but then we had dowel bars too, and then we had the removal cost, and we had this and this. And so much of it is dependent even on the size of the job. I mean, the economies of scale that always come into play on any job. So the range, I would say you can expect right now, we're seeing prices that range installed for precast pavements on highways anywhere from about $220 a square yard up to $500 a square yard, depending upon how close together the repairs are, how many of them there are, how big the project is, what the traffic control is like, how long the work windows are. I mean, a lot of stuff comes into play here. The bigger the job, the closer together the repairs are, the more efficient the contractor can be, the longer the work windows are, the closer those two numbers are going to be to each other. And they may even be damn near equal. I'd say typically, right now, on most jobs where people decide to do precast, the congestion and such is so much that they're probably only going to have a four-hour work window for their actual construction time on cast in place, because they have to have another 3 or 4 hours to cure, right? And on those jobs, we're typically seeing that the precast maybe runs anywhere from even to 20% more. But again, it's so dependent on a job-to-job basis, you can't really say. Yeah. Randy?
Well, I'll just add one other thing to that. One of the things you have going for you on precast that you may not have necessarily on rapid early strength concrete is it's known durability when it goes into place. So if you have a high probability that it's going to last. Sometimes some of your higher early strength concrete not quite as durable as you might like to have
it
going in. Different
water
ratios, too high
sustained content. Too hot. Yeah. And this is why Caltrans is not doing much in the way of rapid set repairs anymore. Caltrans has gone into precast in a huge way. Nira showed you that slide that said there were like 33 lane miles placed as of 2013. Caltrans has got like 27 lane miles going down this year alone. Down in the Los Angeles area, I mean, they're reconstructing pavements with precast for the very reasons Randy talked about. They're getting 2 years of performance out of their rapid sets, some of the rapid sets, not all of them, but you got control of the process in the precast facility. You should have a much greater likelihood of getting a long life, 20, 30, 40 year potential life durability wise out of a precast product. Okay, let's eat. Thank you all very much.
We're doing right on that. We gotta swap out the controller. And this is in Rogers. Thanks. So nowhere to go. Yeah. It looks like it's max on the Mac. I didn't turn it up or anything. That was about what I was getting before. I think it'd be fine.
With the speaker, it's quiet. So it's simple.
I got power. So we're all set.
Awesome.
Please find your seat. We're going to get started again. So we have. Reaching for the hitting the advance.
So this is just one right.
So it's one right. Gotcha. Mirage doesn't make mistakes. The back arrow has a quicker content.
So now they are here.
time to first spoke.
We spent a lot of time talking about bell bars and misalignment tolerances, and I was fortunate to speak at the THE conference last year, I believe, on this topic. I watched compressed window, and I focused very specifically on the engineering thresholds that we use for the misalignment tolerances themselves. Today I have a little more time, even though now we start a little bit behind schedule, but I'm hoping to get more of the story about things out this time around. So if you did see the presentation at the THE conference last year, this will be a nice refresher on things, and hopefully it will expand your scope of things a little bit. I am Robert Rudden. I've been serving as the executive director of ISCP since last September. I do that in quarter time capacity. Previously, I was with the American Cognitive Pavement Association. I was with ACP for about a decade. The last job I had there was a senior director of pavement technology. That's whenever I was working on this particular set of slides and the ACPA specification for Dalbar alignments. I'm from downstate, so I called SONA, grew up in Carlisle, but I now raced to St. Louis, happened to Mount Vernon in St. Louis. Very few people know that. Very small town. So today, here's our overview. How we image hardened concrete is very important. We have to be able to see where the dowel bars are in the concrete itself. We're going to talk about the sources of misalignment and mislocation. Those are two different things. We'll get into the details there. We'll talk about the magnitude of what's acceptable for each of these and a little bit about the guidance and specifications. But we're going to focus mostly on the story and not get too bogged down in the details of the engineering.
The presenter view is not advancing. Give me 1 second. There we go.
Acknowledgements? Didn't you ask myself? Certainly not. I am not the developer of the thresholds themselves. I'm taking other people's engineering work. Those guys like that, it's not that should be a lot of background research on the mechanics of the materials and the dowels and how they interact. Mark Snyder has been very instrumental in that work as well. Mirage has had some experience in dowel misalignment modeling. So there's been a lot of people from a lot of different venues, FHWA, different universities, that have worked on this. At the tail of my presentation, I spelled Bill there incorrectly, and I have some slides from Bill Maverick with ARA. I'm kind of their pupil, I'm just reporting what I observed them talk about and kind of consolidating their guidance into the specification of ACPA released this past year. So, pavement imaging. We got dowel bars at the transverse joints, tie bars at the longitudinal joint. We do not want to have to rip up the concrete to see how misaligned the dowel bars are every time we think we have a problem. So we find ways to look through it like an expert. We have a lot of different approaches to this. There are several that we've developed over the years. We can use GPR, ground penetrating radar. We use this for a lot more than just imaging dowels. It's generally used for other things, in fact. We're only now to the point where we're getting the accuracy and resolution that we need to really see where those dowel bars are. But there's a lot of work that goes into these algorithms, and it's still very subjective to the person doing the calculations themselves as far as what the results will tell you. So there's more error in the side of, well, we measured it, we're pretty confident in what we read, but we're not exactly sure if the dowel is exactly where we're seeing it. This is made great leaps and bounds. There's a couple of DOTs that are really focusing on this. That photo is from Kentucky. I've been looking at it in Missouri as well and in New Mexico. So two states in the U.S. that are trying to push for GPR for dowel imaging. But generally we have another approach that we use. There's another device that we use to image hardened concrete in recent times. This is an ultrasonic shear wave tomography device, also called MIRA. This was imported from Russia by Lev because no one else could read the manual on how to use it, I guess. But now we have it here. Problem here is that it's very time intensive. This little tiny box has to be moved from point to point along the dowel basket itself. But this tells us a lot more than just where the dowels are. We can see socketing of the concrete around the steel. We can look at the exact thickness of the pavement without having any sort of a special thing there. So it looks at the transition from material to material. So this is a
probably more advanced than we need for Dalbar alignment right now. It's very labor intensive to use, but the accuracy is certainly there. The Department of Defense has been looking at this for general purposes, everything from vertical concrete structures, cooling tower, nuclear facilities, whatever it might be. It's a really high resolution way of imaging concrete through its thickness. We're looking for more than just steel. We can find honeycombs and other problems. What we gravitated towards for Dalbar imaging is magnetic imaging. Because the Dalbars are steel generally, we can just drag a device across over the surface, and we'll get to the details there, and ping off of them with this magnetic signal and figure out where the Dalbars are and how they're aligned and located relative to the joint that we've created. We're using this now for thickness as well. This device is called the MITSCAN T2, and you just put out a metal plate, start out like Prisby at a time, put out one of your GPS coordinates, come back later, and you can get very high accuracy reading on how thick the in-place thickness is of the pavement without emitting destructive. So it's a good MET measure. We'll focus now for the rest of the presentation really with this MITSCAN device. It has very high accuracy, very high repeatability. It's very efficient. We can test 400 or more joints in an 8-hour day. We do up to 3 lanes in one pass. So it's a very high production test. It has to be calibrated, though, for the exact valve diameter and spacing that we're using. That's one downside. So there's a calibration factor in place. You can change the calibration after you obtain the raw data, the raw readings. But some devices like the mirror don't necessarily need that sort of calibration to find anything inside the paper. So this specifically, thus far, for round valves at our typical spacings and length, and they must be steel. So we take this set of rails out to the field. That's automatically advancing on me too. Take the set of rails out to the field. It has wheels on there, and even the axles on the wheels have to be plastic. There's no metal near this. No steel-toed shoes, no trucks nearby. Because we're measuring the magnetic signal. So we align that with where we saw the joint. We take the suitcase-shaped device called MITSCAN, put on the wheels, and then somebody just walks it along, and the machine does all the rest of the work. Because we're looking at magnetic imaging, the weather is irrelevant, really. That could be an issue with some of the other measurement techniques, but moisture in the air doesn't matter. The results are immediate, and it's a pretty automated data analysis, too. And a nice software that gives you an exaggerated view of what each of those Dalbars in that joint looks like. You get a nice printout, you get a nice Excel spreadsheet with all that data. There are some application issues, or limitations, I guess, thus far. Because we have this steel basket, if we're replacing with baskets, connecting those dowels from dowel to dowel, that can be far enough apart that it's not that big of an issue. But when we have our shipping tie wires across there, so you see them right there, which are there to keep that basket from opening up during transit, during shipping, that makes a closed loop between those dowel bars, and it throws off the reading. So if we do not have the tie wires, shipping tie wires cut, our results can look like that by doing nothing but cutting the shipping tie wires. Our results look like what we expect to see each of the individual dials. So this has become a challenge. We've engineered solutions around it. I'll touch on that later in the presentations, but we're essentially removing the metal shipping tie wires and now using plastic zip ties near this concern. If we're too close to tie bars, the dial bars and tie bars are too close to the juncture there, it throws off the last couple dial bar readings. Those are erroneously off and the field are not off. So then it comes to the question of, well, if you're going to be placing your tie bars too close to your dowel bars and you know that's going to happen, you have to exclude the first couple dowel bars from your dowel misalignment metrics. So the better suggestion is to move those tie bars away. As Mark suggested earlier, you can be down to 2 or 3 tie bars per panel. They don't have to be regularly spaced. You can change the diameter and the bend and length and everything else to balance the stresses and move them away from where the dowel bars. So here's a typical joint. These results are very telling. In this case, the basket opened on the bottom end. The dowel basket supports an alternating side. If the basket opens, it is dropped. So you see the top end is attached to the basket on alternating sides there. Here we have an anchoring issue, and the basket itself just shoves forward some. And there we're all together missing most of the dowels in that joint. So without doing anything disruptive to the concrete, we can see where our towel bars are. In this case, they lined everything with where they had saw cut the joints. They did their imaging, and all I saw was the tail ends and a tie bar. Now they relocated where they did the measurement, and they realized the saw cut should have been over here, where the towel bars were placed. And we're guessing about saw cut location either. In fact, because of this, some contractors are being a little more proactive and they're measuring where the dowels are before they saw cut the joint. So some of the sources of misalignment and mislocation. So we have these two problems partitioned out because misalignment is what locks the joints. So there we're talking about if our dowels parallel to the surface of the pavement and the edge of the pavement, if it's in any way skewed, which will help lock the joints. Mislocation is separate from that. Mislocation is more about making sure we have a bend in the pit, or the dowel's not too high, such that there's shear capacity issues, or side to side, you're spread out too far apart. But that does not in any way lock the joint. So there's two different parts, misalignment and mislocation. The location, we want them so they're close enough to the surface, but not too close to cause that shearing failure. We want to make sure we have the required embedded depth, which I'm glad Mark got into great detail on that earlier. We want to make sure they're not too close to each other or too far apart or too close to the edge. So on plan view, there's the edge of pavement, first dowel in. We call this horizontal skew. There's where we're going to place the joint. You can see that's going to lock that joint up as the two slabs want to separate. If we stand at the side of the pavement and look at the section view, the vertical tilt is a comparable element in the other direction. So these are both going to help lock the joints. The way that we calculate the amount of misalignment is by considering the two of these together, because they're acting together. You can have one or the other or both at the same time. Then we've got mislocation. We have a planned location, and the dowel somehow is off from that. That's not an issue with baskets generally, but if you have a TVI, a dowel bar insert, that could become an issue spacing from spacing between dowels. You want to make sure they're right on center to what your detail is. Longitudinal translation. We could have placed the dowel here accidentally or saw cut the joint at the wrong spot. This could just be miscommunication in the field during construction that's causing something like that. And the vertical translation, we're now realizing, as Mark said earlier, we don't have to have the dowel bars right at mid-depth. Being in about the middle third is sufficient. And in fact, leveraging that, we can manufacture less different types of dowel baskets. They use the same basket height for maybe 5 to 9 inch thick pavements because it's still in that range that we're looking for. So we get some efficiencies in the production side to reduce the cost of that design detail too. Here's some of the challenges that we face in placement. You can see they've got some concrete. We placed it right up here, probably backing up and in dumping because of space restrictions. And on the fly, they're anchoring that basket right before the pavement or the top. How good could that anchoring possibly be? So baskets can get shoved. You have cases where the baskets get bent in shipping or stepped on after they're already in place. They're not anchored properly, you have the entire basket get shoved forward like that. That's some of the limitations of using a basket. You think, well, they'll hold the dowels parallel to each other, absolutely. But what about any sort of forward tilt, vertical tilt element, if the concrete head pushes that? And if you have any sort of misalignment to the basket, 1 or 2 degrees, every single dowel is mislocated, misaligned. The entire basket compounds the problem. Dowel bar insertion, on the other hand, we insert each dowel independent of the one next to it. And that's a relatively common procedure these days as well. We basically have a portion of the dowel, the slip form paper, that disengages from the slip form paper itself. It sits on the surface, vibrates in the dowel bars with these forks that you see. And then it migrates back out. There's no physical structure inside that concrete to hold that dowel where we placed it. The gradation of the materials, the frequency of these vibrating forks to close the material back up as it lifts back out, and other factors really come into play to make sure that dowel stays exactly where we placed it without interfering with it on the way in or the way out. But you'll see in the tail of this presentation, I'll show you results of alignments. We get better alignments with DBI than with baskets. But they're both still pretty much the same. And again, we can have a mislocation of the saw cut. In a perfect world, We placed some dowel basket out in the field. It made some mark on the subgrader subbase indicating where they need to saw cut that joint. At the middle of that, that's been translated well into the proper saw cut depth, and that joint is activated. It's the perfect build. But if this is off to the left or right where the dowel basket isn't all, or we have a problem with the mislocation of the joint relative to where we placed the steel. So I mentioned earlier, we have some contractors that are imaging these things before they saw cut the joints now. If they're going to be held accountable for the dowel misalignments anyway, well, they have here just a short section of that railing. They have a rough idea of where the dowels are. They image those last couple dowels. We mark on the pavement, they know they're going to hit the baskets every single time. Now, this is catching on with the contracting side because the specs and the requirements for alignments by the owners is driving that. And it's now the case that these pieces of equipment are almost a commodity because this is caught on around the country and around the world that agencies just want to apply the test because they don't have a method of testing for downline. It's really looking for a problem that doesn't exist in some regards. We don't have epidemic problems of panels locking and having a lot of cracking that's been attributed to down misalignment. That's just not the way the concrete pavements tend to fit. We'll get back to that. But right now there's a lot of testing devices to go around. So the thresholds. This is the part that I kind of just want to skim over once we get past this slide. Because this slide, again, and all the other slides, all the other presentations today are available in the Google Drive, and that URL is on the agenda that you got. So you can download this. You can download all the references that I'll mention in the next couple slides as well. So what's the concern with each of these? We've got our horizontal skew and vertical tilt. These are the ones that tend to lock the joint. When we lock the joint, we're concerned about spalling at the joint, near the joint, and cracking either near the joint or somewhere in between panels. We're also concerned about load transfer. When it comes to these mislocation issues, the horizontal translation, longitudinal translation, and vertical translation, we're mostly concerned about load transfer. They don't lock the joint. But a vertical translation too high or too low can start to cause spalling concerns because we'll have a shear failure. Again, these two lock the joints, the other do not. So there's been about 6 or 8 different reports that have looked at various portions of this. And that's why we've had to look at all the research that's been done to date in the development of the spec, because there wasn't one perfect set of guides that existed yet. So all of these resources that I'm going to mention are available as PDFs inside that Google Drive, so you have access to all of them. American Concrete Pavement Association in 2006 released a document that was evaluating and optimizing dowel bar alignment, which was really based on this Portland Cement Association report, which was dowel bar alignments, typical in-service pavements. So we're not looking at thousands and thousands of dowel baskets and DBI in the field, and looked at what was achievable. And if we had any sort of performance issues at these sections, based on what the contractors could and couldn't build. The FHWA has had more documents on this in recent times, and they're the source of much of the guidance that we have for particular thresholds. In 2007, we had best practices for dowel placement tolerances, and had a separate document on the magnetic imaging side of things that gives a lot more detail on the mid scan. And last, there was a big report, this NCHRP report that Levin Mark and some other people worked on, guidelines for dowel alignments in concrete pavements. You'll notice all these dates are early to mid to late 2000s. This is a relatively recent evolution in engineering that we had. In this particular report, they looked at projects in the field, about 35,000 dowels on 60 projects in 17 states. They did lab work, so they had a testing fragment they developed, and they intentionally misaligned dowels and looked at the pullouts and shear capacity and other factors. And then I did some computer work, finite analysis that Mark mentioned earlier, to look at things from a modeling perspective. And lastly, we have that National Concrete Pavement Technology Center report that Mark and someone else mentioned earlier as well. One note that has been mentioned, this document was developed with guides from the National Concrete Consortium. And what that is state agency concrete engineers from around the country get together. and they talk about the problems that they have as a concrete in general, not just pavements. And they meet twice a year. I think that the tollway and the DOT here both have someone engaged in that, but this guidance was really developed to help standardize things across the country. Because every state you go to, there's a different requirement on the diameter of the wire in the dowel basket. And the type of staking device we use to fix that basket down. The dowel's epoxy coating thickness, every little detail, every state was different. And it made it so there's a lot of variation in manufacturing, which adds cost to the channel. So the original intent of this was to try to reduce the variability across the country and help with some standardized designs to reduce the cost of dowel baskets themselves. When it comes to specs, which is what we're pulling from all these reports for, ideally, in a perfect world, the dowel should be placed without any sort of placement repair. Now, if you've ever spent some time on the field, you know that's very, very difficult to accomplish. So stringent but constructible requirements should be specified, and allowance should be made for tolerable errors. What can we tolerate without any sort of impact on performance? We do need improved guidelines for dowel placement tolerances moving forward. These aren't yet answers. We're still learning about this. I think what we have right now is still a little bit conservative. So when I was with the ACPA, this effort started probably 3 years ago now with the guide spec for dowel bar alignment. We reviewed these references that I've just mentioned. We reviewed the existing dowel alignment specifications that were being used around the country. And that included ones from New York, Ohio, province of Ontario, and other spots. This is the second version of this guide spec that's available. It is also in the Google Drive. It's focused on dowels with baskets or with DBI mount, 18 inch long, round, metallic, with and without coatings for corrosion protection. But it's still very specific to metallic because there's some factoring for the accuracy of the testing device itself and the thresholds. And all of this is based on the magnetic imaging method of imaging dowel bars. So when it comes to litigation because of the spec being enforced, the accuracy of the device being used doing the testing, how that impacts the thresholds themselves comes into play. So we're very particular about those details. So this is for joint plane with joint solve perpendicular to the edge of pavement. And at the end of this, there's a summary of all these different resources that I've mentioned. So not only do we give you, here's what the industry suggests the threshold should be, we also, instead of bothering you to go read the reference, we copy the exact paragraph and we can figure out where else we need to support that. Because we're not making up these numbers, they're all based on these engineering reports and research. So I'm going to skip relatively quickly through this alignment tolerances section. Basically, we've identified three different levels. If you're beneath the level that is acceptable, there's nothing to change. If you cross that threshold, you're into a QA trigger. That's when the contractor needs to do some sort of quality assurance, change their processes, to bring everything back in line under the acceptable threshold. If they pass the worst case scenario there, the action threshold, that's when the agency or the owner steps in and there's some sort of mitigating action or reduction in pay or something else. So there's really two thresholds. One is the difference between the accept and the QA trigger. So I'm not going to go through these in great detail as far as the actual value and where it came from. You can go access these slides. I can't imagine you're going to just take the specification and apply it without learning where the numbers came from. So it's not much use for us to spend too much time on these particular numbers and where they were derived. But they're derived from a lot of the research that Mark's explained earlier, such as all we need is 4 inches of abutment length. For an 18-inch long outlet, you need this, how much we can move that joint from side to side, which impacts the longitudinal translation to the point that you can have up to 5 inches of misalignment, or mislocation, rather, of your joint relative to your dowel bars. So there's some of the guidance on where those numbers come from. And some of the experience that Mark mentioned earlier, Minnesota, Tom Burnham saw that they had 2.5 inches is all you need for embedment depth. Good performance. So 4 inches is conservative, even though people have a hard time grasping that. Vertical translation, we're really just concerned about cover depth, but we also have to be concerned about where the saw cut is. You want the saw cut into the dowel bars are. So there's references for where all those numbers come from. and the idea that the dowels really need to be in the middle third of the slab, concerned about cover depth, and by considering this particular factor, for example, we're going to have 1.5-inch dowels, height to the center of the dowel, let's have the basket's 5 inches, and we use that same basket on 10 to 12 inch thick pavements, rather than always requiring it in the middle of the depth. Horizontal translation, we don't see that in the basket placements. It's very rare with DBI as well. This essentially causes no difference. Our dowel standards, as they are very, very conservative at 12 inches on center. So this horizontal skew and vertical tilt, I said we take these two things combined together because they're both acting together to lock up the joint. We basically just use Pythagorean's theorem here. We're looking at the single dowel misalignment, SDM is what we call it. And it's just this square root of the addition of the squares. So we're solving for one part of the triangle. And we have limitations on horizontal skew and vertical tilt separately from each other. And we also have a threshold for the single dowel bar misalignment, because that's really what's causing the problem. And there's a system then to pull this misalignment from dowel to dowel across one joint together, which is called the joint score. Because when I have 12 dowels across one slab width, each of those might have a certain amount of misalignments to it. So we use this joint score equation, which is just 1 plus the sum of some weighting factors. And those weighting factors are based entirely on that single dowel bar misalignment. So if it's very, very low, less than 0.6 of an inch combined, we have a weighting factor of 0. If it gets very, very misaligned, greater than 1.5 inches combined, we have a joint score of 10. Or that one single, or sorry, a weighting factor of 10. We look at the total joint score, and that gives us an assessment of the how locked the joint might be, which in our traditional thinking suggests that if the joint is locked, we're going to have some sort of cracking nearby that, especially if we get a couple of these in a row. So note on this. There's this plus 1, a nice round number out front. And when engineers see things like that, they start to become suspect about where these things came from. So I asked the originator, Tom Yu, he was with CTL Group at that time, whenever he developed this equation, why there's a plus 1 out front. And he said, well, just based on the evidence that we had and using these weighting factors and drawing the line in the sand, we had a value of 9. 9 didn't seem very official, so we added 1 to it, and we ended up with 10. That 10 seems like a nice threshold. So that's, you know, we're still learning about this stuff. It's one example of how we've put some opinion into the things. We also have to adjust that joint score trigger. 10 is kind of the standard that we're looking for, but if we have more or less dowels for the slab, well, we might have to adjust that number down as well. So there's little tiny nuances to applying this. But here we see across one joint. This dowel's aligned well, we have a joint score addition of 0 with this weighting factor. 0 with the next one. This dowel has a little bit of skew to it, so we add 2. And across that entire joint, we sum up the values from all the dowel bars and look at what our threshold is. The joint score is less than 10, essentially, we're generally good. There's also the factor of how long of a section we're tying together. It's not as simple as tying together two panels. You have two 15-foot slabs, you tie those together, you're not guaranteeing that you're going to have a crack in that longer panel. There's still 15 feet of free slab relative to that joint. So you have to lock up several joints in a row for this to become an issue, and suggested that you need a lock distance of about 60 feet before you have any sort of real problems, with locking being the issue. So fail installation and the tie to performance. What is achievable? How does this actually impact things? So, Bill Vavrick had a summary report on some of the investigations that ARIA was doing at, on I-90, the tests were from 2013, I believe. This is at the end of 2013 that he pulled together this particular report. We do have Dan Gankars, is that how you say last name? With ARIA here today. I believe he did a lot of the imaging himself. So, if you're looking for an expert on the application of this mid-scan device in the field, the gentleman with the ARA shirt on during the break would be the guy to talk. So our threshold for single dowel misalignment is at 0.6. And this is the amount that we see based on this report that Tom Yu developed with the CTL group. years ago to see how things are actually installed in the field. And we see that if we add these two together, looking at 80-90% of the dowels in the field without ever being imagined that they were going to be imaged are within this threshold. And we see that full width baskets, those are the blue lines, are about the same as dowel bar insertion. Dowel bar insertion can get as good of alignments as full width baskets that are anchored down ahead of time. We don't see too much objectionable based on just imaging of sections in the field. So full width baskets and dowel bar insertion, pretty comparable. Now we're seeing this trend towards wheel path baskets. This is a case from I-90. So instead of having one basket across the entire width, 12 dowels in it, now that that's 5 and 5. What we're recognizing is the dowel standards that we use were developed in the 1960s by ACI. And it was a group of people sitting around the room. There's always special interest in those sort of groups. And they decided that 12 inches on center, 8 inches long was good enough. That's what we needed. Obviously, some steel salesmen in those particular discussions, we didn't really try to optimize anything. The initial dowels that we tested were about 4 feet long and we did 2 per wheel path. There was already an original thought towards optimizing things and putting the steel where the load transfer occurs. From the time we lost sight of that, we said, let's just do 12 inches on the center. Now, there's this emerging trend towards getting rid of dowels in the middle of the slab. There's no wheels crossing over there anyway. Put the steel where we need it. In this particular case, they just dropped 2 dowels out in the middle. The contractors like that. They might be able to change the spacing from the edge of pavement to that first dowel. When they get into curves, sometimes that hangs up things and causes some misalignment, so there's some benefits from the contracting side too. But from an alignment perspective, now we have 2 independent systems. So we have 2 opportunities to either cause more misalignments or do things better. I already went out there and imaged that and the other types of placement methods because on I-90 they did these half lane wheel path baskets, the full width baskets, and they used DBI because there were different contractors on different sections and they all got tried. So we'll get back to that. But here's some more examples of this trend towards using less steel. Mark talked about making the dowels shorter. I'm talking about just throwing some dowels out of the design in a place where they're not providing any value. This is the Utah DOT standard at this point, 4 and 4. Here's the case in Idaho. Instead of 12, they just have 9 dowels. As I said, well, we're tired of this issue with dowel bars and tie bars, so we'll just push our tie bars a little bit closer and drop some dowels on the outside. Here's a county of Minnesota where they're using 3 dowels. This is a 2-lane undivided highway, tied in the middle, 3 dowels just on the outside wheel paths. So the super in the middle, there's no sort of load transfer. They're assuming that tie joint across there is accomplishing that. So there's different approaches to this. Now we have finite elements analyses of different ways of trying to look at these things before we build them, but if you're studying 1,000 inches on center, you consider alternate designs. So back to that I-90 case and the imaging that they did out there. So they did full width baskets. They did wheel pad baskets. And they used dowel bar insertion. And we're seeing the threshold of the average values from the old ACPA study superimposed over here. We'll look at that just to show that they're not getting as good of alignment on the I-90 project as the overall sample that was developed by ACPA a couple years prior. But we're still seeing that 0.6 being our threshold of what's starting to become a concern as a combined single dowel misalignment. We stack those up on here, where about 80% of the dowels are in that very good range. We also see that dowel bar insertion, the gray bar, actually produced the largest amount of dowels that were aligned very, very well. Now, Dan Rigenbaugh, this particular, was the sample size very different? I don't remember those details. Were there a lot less DBIs than the other ones?
No, there's actually more DBIs.
So more DBIs, the R's there. So DBI does work. It's been a long time to get acceptance for that sort of dowel placement method in some places of the country. We're now seeing a lot of innovations in the dowel space. With all the design details that we have to deal with as concrete pavement engineers, this is probably the space that's seen the most innovation in the last decade. A lot of it's been driven by the industrial sector. because this whole idea of differential deflection that Niraj alluded to earlier, in highway systems, we're talking about load transfer efficiency. That works well for us because we're driving with pneumatic tires, so it's in the air. Now, when it comes to the industrial side, they move towards having very small wheels of metal or plastic on forklifts and other devices. They've gone away from having pneumatic tires. So any differential deflection at all causes one side to be deflected and the other side to get eaten up by that hard wheel. And there's a lot more spawn. So they've developed these different plate technologies to distribute the load over a larger area and reduce the bearing stresses. And that reduces the deflection. I've also developed different geometries. And the idea there is to have less restraint whenever they're placing next to sections that have already been placed. So they do a lot of strip placements, like you would see in an airfield, place a lane, skip a lane, place a lane. Those sections will contract, and then we tie into that a new concrete section in the middle, which wants to contract after the other section has already done so. And then we end up with differential cracking between the two placements. So these plate valves, just by geometry alone, when the concrete shrinks back from them, they allow a little bit of lateral movement. Not a lot, but just enough lateral movement that we get rid of that restraint. So they'd be useful in things like traffic circles, horizontal curves, places where the transverse joints aren't parallel to each other. Because in most cases, the slab's not contracting perfectly axial. You like to think that it is, but it's not. So there's a core with one. The MedScan can't see that, the Vera could though. So depending on what device you're using, you might need to use a different imaging technology. For construction joints, leveraging that idea of embedded depth on you to be about 2 inches, they've now also developed these devices that are shaped like footballs. They just make a saw cut in, half off that radius, and slide in a device that does a load transfer. There's a roadway example. I've seen that used in airfields as well. Now, the point of this is within the context of alignment. You see this dot right here? You can misalign that about 5 to 10 degrees, and there's no restraint, no locking in the joint, just because of the taper. You have to bring it past the point of where this curved shape is tilted the other way for it to start to lock up. So there's a little wiggle room in the placement tolerances as well. So some of these newer valve technologies might trickle into roadway paving if misalignment becomes important enough and there are any challenges achieving it. Here are those zip tie wires. Very simple adaptation of shape of tie wires. Time to get out of that. Now we don't have that closed conduction loop that throws off the imaging. And there's another innovation out of Kentucky here that was released about a year ago called the KY brace. So what they have here, in the plane of the basket itself, so that's angled here, these little triangles are manufactured and in that plane. Somebody comes along later once the dowel basket is placed, and they have this metal stick that pops into this rod here, and they rotate those out, just pivot them out. And all it does is provides a little triangle there that gives you just enough support on each side that without these zip tie wires, the head of concrete pushes on that, there's that restraint to those little triangles. So it just keeps the basket from deforming, from pushing forward or backwards at all under the weight of the concrete. So we're developing ways to address those sort of issues once we're seeing this large increase in the amount of imaging of valves that's going on. So now quickly on the performance. Findings from the Portland Cement Association study really that CTL group did suggests that the alignment is generally very good across the country from the samples that they had, but almost always there were some projects or some joints that had poorly aligned dowels. So occasionally this would cause enough of a concern that we might consider a joint to be locked. We don't really see any sort of significant performance issue. What we saw in the field was that the poor dowel alignment might cause looseness around the dowel. I don't have an image here for that, but essentially if we have our joint and our dowels misaligned, the experts now including that, we'll contend that before you lock up that joint enough for a crack to happen somewhere else, you're going to end up getting some sort of conical fracture on one side or the other. So the concrete will just shear out, basically, because of the misalignment. And over the long term, might have a loss in load transfer efficiency. So but you're not going to call a new panel cracking on one side of the other. I can't believe we lost thoughts about cracking. We're starting to learn it's not that. So here are some examples from the field from that particular study. We're looking at the joint score, with 10 being objectionable in the joints across that project. In this case in Indiana, for basket placement, they had one joint that was very, very severely misaligned. Dowels were skewed such that the joint score was very, very high, but they didn't have any cracking at that joint or anywhere near there. So that one joint wasn't enough to cause a problem in 5 years. We expected really that it was going to happen. Here's for dowel, our DBI, dowel bar insertion placement in Kansas. They've got a couple lateral lead thresholds here. They didn't have any problems with that particular project either, 6 years in. Here's a case from Georgia, where every single joint is way out of scale. Guess what? They didn't have any cracking, but that's turned off spalling, and their joints were starting to fault. So this is a dowel concrete pavement with faulting happening. So again, we're contending that this sort of failure, not the bin panel cracking, which is really what all of our concern is about, this sort of loss of long-term load transfer efficiency is what we're going to see manifested. And that's why we don't see widespread problems with cracking because of dowel bars. They don't happen until 20 or 30 years down the road where we start to have faulting happen on dowel pavements when we didn't expect it. So no cracking there, joint scores. Really, really bad. So we know that the joint score is not the holy grail. We still have to learn more and find different ways and metrics of quantifying on sort of the degree of misalignment and our concern for cracking the performance side. Luckily, this is not something that's fallen off the radar. FHWA, from my understanding, and I believe this is still an ongoing project, ARA has a contract to go out and look at different long-term pavement performance sections around the country. So what this is, here are the jointed plane sections around the U.S. The different state DOTs got together and said, well, you build your pavements under your spec using your design details and your materials and construction practices and everything else. We'll do ours differently over here. We'll build this massive database after monitoring all these sections. And that's to do APPG or Ashton Wear Pavement Duty. It's all calibrated to that data from all these sections around the country. You can get access to that raw data for free now. A very easy-to-use website called Pavement.com, but ARA has a contract to go out and measure these sections that are still in service and get the actual dowel misalignment for every single joint on that section, and then try to tie together joint score or some other metric to performance, because this is the best data that we have for long-term performance on the data. And now we have the means to go out and measure the dowel bar, so we're just connecting those dots. My understanding was that Sri Rao was the AR on that for ARA. He told me this spring or last fall that he was having some problems getting access to some of the sites. So just maintenance of traffic was an issue in some of the locations. So they were a little bit behind schedule. But hopefully we'll have a more definitive answer on what things need to be very, very soon because of that. So the ACPA guides back this document. This has also inside it guidance on trial sections, the testing procedures themselves, or QC, QA exclusions for areas that you shouldn't necessarily have a concern for, the measurement equipment, dealing with interference reporting, and corrective action. This is the second iteration of this document. ACPA is looking at this now to develop and enhance it some more. We're going to add in procedural limits for pay factor and some other features. And if you want to model, you can expect that. Totally this year is now using a performance related specification for PRS, the content that includes for the Dallas a PWL spec. So there's already been some pretty well guidance on that basis as well. I think the only other place that was using PWL was the province in Ontario and Canada. So it's a relatively newer thing. So with that, are there any questions? Dallas and okay, I'm going to jump to Jake. Thank you. Okay, well, thank you very much for your patience here. My name is Jay Kenner. I'm a faculty member at Michigan Tech University. About 7 hours straight north here, south of the lake. We're talking a little bit about recycled materials, byproducts, or co-products, depending on who you're talking to, is it a byproduct or co-products? A co-product means someone's making money off it, I guess. And waste materials, and how to look at a few ways to kind of characterize materials for use in concrete pavements. Before we start, I have a few announcements here. We'll talk a little bit about a study we did for the Michigan Department of Transportation a few years ago. We touched a little bit about some stuff with the LNMUT that Professor Jeff Reisler did, looking at wastewater and use of recycled asphalt pavement mesh in concrete. So, with that, why do we want to recycle materials into new concrete pavements? We've had some successes in the past, some miserable failures. But you know, we look at the different things here, again, trying to reduce consumption, and let's talk about sustainability here, triple bottom line focus on using materials and trying to get excellent long-term performance with those materials would be advantageous if we could characterize those correctly. Now, potentially, in some cases, we might be able to save money. In some cases. In other cases, maybe not. And a lot of this really ties into having a high level of performance. If we don't use recycled materials, it seems like a very sustainable thing to do. However, we're not going to get performance. If we're going to get 15 years of performance, or we would have got 25 to 30 years with a new concrete pavement with any virgin materials, you know, that's not very sustainable. And so to kind of get that high level performance, we need to really look at characterizing the materials. So, I'll think of the questions to kind of think about since we kind of talked about today here. How do we decide what materials we can recycle? Okay, we'll talk about a few different things we can recycle. That is a lot of materials we can recycle in concrete pavements here. What about the recycled materials can we use? If we want to use recycled concrete as an aggregate in new concrete, can we use 100% of those aggregates in new concrete? In some cases, maybe, but in some other cases, might be not a little questionable. What's the performance required for the new roadway structure? You want to put questionable materials in there, ones that are trying 40 plus years of service life there. You know, that's a high risk. Okay, maybe looking at lower routes, less critical routes, maybe it's a different kind of place to use some of these things here. Any issues to consider, existing pavement condition. You know, was this concrete that you might want to reuse? Was it decracked? Was there ASR problems? What kind of, you know, what was the cause of the failure of this? Processing transportation costs, is this an urban job or do you recycling maybe on site? Is this something you need to basically ship things out? This can take a huge, huge effect on cost. And the effect of this material on those concrete properties. So I want to talk about a few certain things here today. So what components can be recycled on concrete? Well, one can recycle cement. Okay. Or you supplementary some additional materials as replacement, byproducts, co-products in some ways. Okay. Or aggregates. We can take all the concrete, we can crush it, go through the process of crushing it carefully. We'll talk a little bit about that. But we could use those in many ways. A new concrete, maybe it's a base material on another concrete pavement. Fine aggregates. This one's a little questionable. We'll hit this a little bit, but we could potentially use fine aggregates. And then one we don't talk a lot about is recycled water. Okay. These are things that we can possibly recycle and are using now to be put into new concrete in the concrete pavement. So we'll hit on all these in some different fashion here today. I kind of wish the scope of this problem, this presentation was a little bit smaller. I feel like I'm going to go through a lot of materials here today. And I wish that in some cases I get a little bit more detail. But we'll kind of touch on a few things here today. We'll talk about, again, cement replacements. Particularly supplementary some additional materials or SEMs. SEMs is a little less easier to say than supplementary some additional materials. Talk about fly ash. Talk about ground granulated plastic slag. Or again, I'm off of there, but it's called slag. And we'll talk slag with you. We'll talk about recycled waste aggregates, recycled carburetors, RCA. We'll talk about recycled or reclaimed asphalt for our hat. We'll talk about other ways, other different materials that we can recycle as aggregates. And we're doing some positives and some negative things we need to sort of look out for if we want to look at those. And then we'll get to talk a bit about recycled water. So, first thing I'll talk about today is supplementary cementitious materials. So, we'll start talking about the hydration process. We'll go back and forth through the last 3 years here. We'll see some groans, see some other ways here. That's why we keep some of those years and kind of get away from the chemistry. But the chemistry is important too, okay? The hydration process, we add cement, we add water, there's this hydration process that's happening. And kind of understanding a little bit about it makes it sort of advantageous to kind of optimize this. So when we look at this, when we're manufacturing cement, the world in every concept you make, we're probably putting up between 0.9 and 1, depending on what's one factors here, a ton of CO2 on the X. You talk to any cement manufacturer, they'll probably tell you that probably the number one problem that they have right now is the perception of CO2 emissions. So about half of this CO2 comes from calcination. Taking this limestone, heating it up, and heating it up to an absurd temperatures, gave us here water today, 1,450 degrees Celsius. To give you a little reference how hot it is, the surface of the sun is about 5,000 degrees Celsius. Okay, so we've got to heat this up to about enough energy to heat this up to about a third of the temperature of the surface of the sun for this process to happen. Okay, the calcination process to go from limestone to lime, to go from limestone and silica to C3S, it takes a lot of heat. Okay, a lot of energy to get into that heat. So a lot of that CO2 comes from the fossil fuels or the heat energy to sort of generate that amount of heat. And you have the scientists who are doing a lot of work on trying to get this down. You can get to this calcination process. So one of the things we've got to do to start looking at some more sustainable approaches to this, since we are going to do with Portland cement here, is by using nutrients, supplementary cementitious materials. We've got three different ones here. We've got class C fly ash, we've got a K1 silica fume, class F fly ash, slag, calcium shale. A few of these are industrial byproducts. Okay. And I'll handle those today in terms of more sort of sustainable approaches to sort of adding to our concrete mixes here. And the first one I want to talk a little bit about is fly ash. Fly ash goes back decades. Okay. This is not necessarily anything new. It's a byproduct of bullring. Again, I'll call it a co-product because they're in term form, no? But it's a byproduct. It's not engineered for our use. It's a waste material that does have advantageous properties for producing concrete. Okay. Typically, we're breaking down into different classes, a class F fly ash, a class C fly ash. The biggest difference here is the chemical composition. You start looking at the class F fly ash, it's high in silica, okay, SiO2. This is so-called pozzolanic material. We also have class C fly ash, which also contains silica, it contains some calcium, in some cases a free lime that has some sort of hydrologic properties. And they'll actually get water to start a hydrogen sort of snap to it. So having the positive reaction is sort of the ideal case in this scenario here. There's a positive reaction where you start to create the other hydrogen products, sort of a secondary reaction that's happening. I'm going to look at specs for flash here. You know, what's classified as a class F flash or a class C flash? The specifications of what this is. One really important thing to remember about flash is that flash is not an engineering material. We're not setting it up around the coal plant trying to figure out how to come up with the most optimized flash. It's a waste product. And we call something class F flash. You can have three different products that are class F flash, making three very, very different flashes. I mean, three very, very different things to your concrete. So I think it's a very important thing to recognize. So we'll spend some chemistry here. If you want to kind of look at the very simplistic look at hydration of cement, okay? And primarily here we looked at the components called C3S and C2S, which make up probably about 75% of our bag of cement, our type 1 bag of cement. We take that, we have water, we get two primary hydration products. Calcium silicate hydrate, CSH gel. And the CH called calcium hydroxide. CSH is kind of an amorphous material. It's a very strong material. It's got very low permeability. Everything that we want in a good concrete comes from that CSH. And CH here, this is more flaky. It's a crystalline structure. It's got okay strength, very permeable, but not necessarily as advantageous to having a high quality concrete. But you know, we get both of those in this reaction. We add water to create both of these hydration products. So what's the real genius of a positive reaction? If you have extra silica, let's say in class F flash, for instance, is when you get these two hydration products here. What if we had the silica from some sort of positive material? plus this calcium hydroxide from this equation here, and excess water, we actually have more CSHGO. What is this stuff? Okay? We kind of get rid of some of this weaker material. So this weaker material, and replace it with some of the stronger, less permeable material. So again, it gives us a better long-term strength. Now, one of the problems with this is it doesn't happen instantaneously. This is a long-term process. We start looking at positive reactions. We're not getting positive reactions on a 7-day window. Okay? We're looking long-term, 28 days, 56 days, long-term for these reactions to start to happen. So we're still looking at some problems last year. In terms of workability, most people that work with fly ash can tell you that the workability of these concretes are really good. Okay. So if you look at a real fishing concrete, they're actually pretty happy to work with fly ash in this part. When you're looking at long term, you're still going to get increased strength. You're going to get increased fracture properties, increased durability from that positive reaction. But again, we're looking for even 28 days strengths. We might be looking at weaker concrete 28 days. We're looking at 90 days, looking long term. The use of these SCMs typically gives us a much better strength over time and much reduced permeability. Okay, so chlorides aren't feeding down those kind of things here. So, again, a few things to consider when we look at this here. It's a very slow reaction, it takes a long time. But look at the sound replacement level. How much fly ash do you use? Anyone working with fly ash at all, right? Here's some typical numbers what they use for sound replacement fly ash. 20-25% stronger. Now, that's what we're typical for fly ash. We did project mission tech and look at 60%. And that's not completely. We would be doing that again. But that's a class C fly ash. We just tried it. It didn't work out well. But in general, it's pretty economic. Fly ash is a pretty affordable product here. One bad thing, we might have time on carbon. If you're fly ash, you can. It's because it's a class F fly ash or class C fly ash. It's not the exact same thing. It's the same thing when you go into the hardware store and get a type 1 bag of cement. This type 1 bag of cement from St. Mary's isn't the same thing as a type 1 bag of cement from the barge. It'd be two very, very different things that fit a broad category of what's called type 1 cement. Okay. Some of these fly ashes might have carbon, which has a big problem interaction with the air train agents in many cases here. So getting your the airborne system is a problem if you have high currents, so things to kind of watch out for. Our next SCM I'm talking about is silicon. Okay. So again, a byproduct from the silicon industry here. Pretty expensive stuff, okay? We're looking at this. In some cases, you know, about 8 to 10 times the price of cement, for the same quantity, is raising your diagonal cost, which I guess silicon's not cheap, even if it's a byproduct here. We're typically using it for high-performance concrete. One phenomenal thing when we start looking at this is it's a highly polyolefin material. We need silica to be a polyolefin material. Silica, if you can get silica in the name, okay, we're talking 95-97% of the material is silica. It's almost a pure polyolefin. So if we get it in a concrete, we can get it distributed well, so that's a problem. We can get some very, very high-strength concrete with really low permeability loss. One key thing we start looking at silicon is the size. Okay. I'm going to have a grain of cement. Okay, you're typically looking at 10 to 15 microns. We're looking at a grain of silicon, we're talking two orders of magnitude smaller than that. To give you an idea how small silicon is, if you took 1 kilogram of cement and we looked at the total surface area of all those particles in 1 kilogram, 2.2 pounds. That would be about the surface area of the end zone of a football field. Okay. If we take that same 1 kilogram, 2.2 pounds of silica field, and we add up all the surface area, all those very, very small particles, it's about 4 football fields of area we need in 2.2 pounds. Just to give you some idea of how small this is. Okay. Why that's good in some ways is even if we don't get that positive reaction, it's kind of filling in those gaps. Those voids that might be in our concrete at the micro level, maybe even close to that nano level, they're filling in gaps. So even if the reaction does not happen, it's still filling those gaps and it gives permeability good strength. So again, we start looking at the silicon, some good things and bad things about it here. Workability, generally pretty tough. Okay. Anyone's trying to finish concrete silicon,
typically had some problems. Actually, one time they have a big problem here is the distribution and so on. Trying to get sort of uniformly separated. So you end up getting sort of this, you've seen some of like some slurries, seen beds of isolated view. You know, I've seen pockets of like softball size pockets of silicon that never broke up, starting with bridge decks. That's not good. Okay. That's an idea that we're trying to be sustainable, trying to get this high performance concrete, but the construction side really didn't work too well. But when it does work well, strength high, permeability low. The two key things we get for high quality, long-term durable concrete. So, in some cases, light effect shrinkage is something that we'll talk about later. In the ground shrinkage, so that might be an issue. Get very closely. And in some cases, we can see ASR problems with this. Okay. Our last SK1 we want to talk about here today is ground grain plated glass in the slide, or GGBFS, or this better slide. Because I don't want to be there yet. So, again, this is a byproduct we're going to deal with. Processing here. One thing about slag is it's really dependent on location. So in the Midwest here, Chicago, Detroit, Cleveland, Pittsburgh, getting slag is not a problem at all. Okay, and this is an industrial byproduct that we're basically going to get pretty easily. Now, if you have areas of the country that don't really have a steel producing or iron ore or processing facilities nearby, it might be tough to get. It might be more expensive in this case. But never right here, there's and positive. So again, something's kind of hydraulic. I can add water to it, and it'll start to self-cement. And something else will start to happen with just slag. So sometimes we see slag, you will see positive properties. When we talk about positive, we look at silica fume. If I take silica fume and put it in a bucket of water and mix it together, and come back 7 days later, what's going to be there? It's going to be a dirty bucket of water. Nothing will react. If I take slag and the same thing, it will start to react. Okay, it'll start to harden up. It'll bond things together, bond things together. So you're going to start looking at slag here. A lot of good properties here. Workability is pretty good, and strength is good because we're getting those positive, high strength, low permeability. One nice thing about slag compared to some of these other SEMs is that we can actually start getting some early strength requirements. Because this has a lot of hydraulic properties itself, if we can add this and start replacing this cement, it actually can sort of give us higher strengths. Whereas if we take, for instance, let's say silica fume, and we can wait for probably, instead of 20 days, we'll be waiting 56 days and can give those strengths. Okay. This can still give us pretty high strengths if done right. So, cost and reasonable. Availability is somewhat of an issue. Again, cement replacement levels in some cases are going to be much, much higher than these other SEMs. Okay, what I want to talk about, quite a bit about here today is recycled areas. We look at recycling materials, recycling concrete. This is sort of a big thing to kind of look at here. Here's a little picture of looking at a normal virgin aggregate and a recycled concrete aggregate. What you see is different. Are they quite different? Size is the same, the same sieve, okay? But extremely different, okay? We'll talk about what some of these differences are and how it affect our concrete performance if we want to reuse those in new concrete. So, yeah, cyber concrete areas are RCA. They just go back and crush it up. And we can crush it in many different ways. These old aggregates might have old mortar. We probably have old mortar on there, high grade mortar. Then what is a one-hydrate cement? Yeah. We start looking at even very old concrete. We can pull 100-year-old concrete and look at 100 cement that just grew hydrated. Big cement grain particles that never fully hydrated. You crush those up, you get water, it doesn't start to hydrate. Okay. One bad thing about RCA is it has some contaminants. Steel rebar, joint sealant, base material, you get sort of dug up in there. Yeah, it's not a perfect material, so we're dealing with something that's probably lesser quality in certain cases here. One big thing, I just want to highlight this. Just like we talked about fly ash, it'd be three different fly ash, and I'll characterize the same. RCA is completely different depending on the crushing process. just because you say, well, I got to recycle limestone, this is all limestone, it shouldn't have right for a reason, that doesn't necessarily mean you crush it in different ways to get different properties out of it. And we'll talk a little bit about precious processes here. RCA has been used in many, many states, including Illinois in some cases here. I've been longer than Michigan has. They're very apprehensive for many years using RCA. They did it in the 1980s. They had, I think, it was like 600 lane miles of concrete pavements. They used it in several concrete aggregates in their new concrete. They had some very, very poor performance. And so instead of really kind of investigating it, they kind of put a moratorium on it in 1991. They started sort of revisiting it about 20 years later. So we look at the production of RCA again. How are you going to get this RCA? How are you going to sort of crush it? How are you going to process it? It's going to be different material. Even if it was the same material to start with. So, again, typical steps here. Evaluation of the concrete source. One of the key things about using RCA is knowing what we're there to begin with. So if you basically have the mix design from 25 years ago, you know what you put down there. It's a known quantity, what the errors were, where they came from, what the mix design was, what the air content was. Okay. You start getting other sort of waste topics, you might not know it. And so that's a big advantage. If you're using sort of newer materials, you know that the source of the concrete is. The breaking and rooting process, removal of bed steel, this is usually a two-step process here. Crushing and sizing can also be a two-step process. But again, how are you going to go about doing this? How are you going to stockpile it? It's going to make a difference. If I crush concrete and I leave it there for years, this is another what's called carbonation. Okay, it's actually going to absorb the CO2 into that. It's a different material. Versus if I crush it, put it in the concrete, you know, 10 days later. It's a very different material. I'll give a few different ways to go about breaking the concrete in terms of breaking more slabs, larger sizes, put your resin breaker, you're going to need smaller sizes to begin with. This is probably going to break it up into much smaller sizes to begin with. So sort of the crushing operation is much more efficient, but it's also probably producing much more fine material, waste material. A couple different crushers here. We can look at sort of the jaw crusher. This generally has larger materials, can handle things maybe up to 12 inches in some cases, break it down